I get so jazzed up. You're like, oh, it's starting. It's starting.
Guys,
it's starting.
You ready?
It's starting.
It's starting, guys. Shh, shh, shh. Shh, shh, shh.
And we're on TV.
We're on the internet. Whoa, this is so surreal.
We're on TV.
Hi.
Good
evening.
What's up, guys?
And welcome to the Riot Sessions. I am your interesting and weird DM, Shadowhack 90, or Nathan. I'm going to turn it over to Blue Ranger so he can introduce what this is, what's happening, and why you're seeing six people on your screen.
I forgot that this is my channel this week. Yay! So if you're here and you're just like, what the hell is going on right now? This is the Riot Sessions. It is a Dungeons & Dragons campaign that traditionally we do over on Shadowhack 90's channel, which is the guy up at the top there. About once a month, and we haven't actually talked about this, but I think that this is what about the first week
of
every month?
That's what we decided, or if I didn't tell you, I decided it last week.
Well, the decision was made without me, even though I thought the same thing, so I don't know.
We simultaneously made the decision without actually talking to each other about it, and it works.
So basically, the Dungeons & Dragons campaign takes place over on his campaign, but in order to reach some of my audience, once a month, we do it over here. It'll be the first week, every first Sunday of every month. This is Storm King's Thunder. It is 5th edition. These are five amazing people. If you've been here long enough, you probably know Ramsbug, because she mods in the channel quite frequently. I play games with ShadowCon. He's over there on the regular. Or not. That works too.
we didn't play it all this weekend.
We didn't play it. Well, we didn't stream it, but we totally
you
didn't.
Call
yeah.
Me blue.
What? For what? For what?
Oh. ShadowCon misses you.
He's being sarcastic. We played games for like 7 hours last night.
It was a decent amount of time.
It was a large chunk of time. They were pretty sick of me. But this is the Dungeons & Dragons campaign. I don't need to drag this out anymore. We're going to introduce ourselves as we go around, but I'm going to pass it back up to our illustrious Dungeon Master, Shadowhack 90.
Once again, hi. I'm Shadowhack 90. I'm your Dungeon Master. I'm the person who helps tell the story and gets a chance to roll some dice and basically make these guys' lives, their characters' lives, hell, or make them the heroes of the story. I haven't decided which yet. I'm going to turn it over to the lady who is currently, her camera is underneath mine. I'm going to turn it down to that lady. She can introduce who she's playing this evening.
Hi, I'm Ramsbug. I'm playing Jessica with a K. She is a dragonborn cleric, and she's sort of in crisis with her god Bahamut because she's supposed to not kill things, and she's really good at killing things. So I'll go, down this way. To Mr. Blue.
Oh, hi. It's me again. I just talked. But you know who I am. I'm the Blue Ranger, and I'm playing the role of Dryden. He is a half-orc barbarian who is just really good at getting hurt. So now that I'm not stone anymore, I'm going to try to get involved with some more action, and we're just gonna keep going across the way over here to Sir Zach of Gethington.
Hey, everybody. My name's Zach. Tonight, I will be playing, well, tonight and hopefully future nights, if everything goes okay. I'll be playing Geth, the half-elf gunslinger. Pow, pow. And I will take it right above me here to Cody Bedrock.
Hey, guys, what's going on? I'm Cody Bedrock, 36, and I'll be playing the human blood hunter, Brontor Jordanian, who is just now coming into what he thinks is his time with this party. So
yeah.
Right above me, we're going to my man, ShadowCon.
Hi, everybody. I'm ShadowCon. If you didn't catch it, I'm ShadowCon. I'm playing Tomp. He is a little halfling ranger, and most of you know that he likes to get down and dirty. He's a little crazy hippie guy. And with that, we'll shoot it back over to whoever's going next.
I'm going to deflect it down to their human gunslinger, or half-elven gunslinger, Geth, so he can get you guys up to speed on what happened last week in the Riot Sessions.
Last time on the Riot Sessions, our heroes, tired and weary from exploring the excavation site, continued their journey to Neverwinter. On the roads, they learn more about their new traveling companion, Harshnag, the Frost Giant. Along their travels, our heroes stopped into the town of Hundlestone to rest and recuperate. Our heroes were met with Brokad Ingotsword, the chief excavator in town, after Harshnag scared half the town nearly to death. As our heroes made their way through the town, a hole opened up in the middle of the town and out poured four basilisks ready to kill. Our main hero, Geth, valiantly fought off the basilisk, saving the rest of the group multiple times in an amazing display of skill and prowess. However, despite Geth's efforts, Dryden was struck by a basilisk just before its dying breath and was petrified to stone. Our heroes scrambled to formulate a concoction that could rescue him. Luckily, they found the perfect mixture of basilisk bile and blood. They found their way to the inn after escaping death to discuss some of the strange magical happenings with some gnome who is a member of the Harpers. And that's where we pick up this week on the Riot Sessions. This week's session of the Riot Sessions brought to you by Ingotsword's Miracle Remedy, homemade basilisk goop for all your medical needs.
Cool. I love that it went from corner to.
That was beautiful.
Our main hero.
Oh man,
that was awful. Our main hero, Geth. I was like, you bastard.
That was fantastic. So yes, it is here that we pick up. Okay, bring it back. It is here that we pick up in the sudden bear tavern. You have all just finished up some drinks, finished up kind of getting a little bit of a slight rest in. A slight rest in from fighting the basilisks, and just kind of getting a chance to talk to. Getting a chance to talk to Thwip Ironbottom about the kind of happenstances and strange things that have been going on within this town of Huddlestone. You asked him to inspect some stuff. You guys went and did a little bit of shopping. You returned to the Sudden Bear. What would you like to do?
Well, what a time we just had, huh, guys?
What happened?
Oh, yeah, you remember all of that there, bro?
Man, it was wow.
Good times.
Dang. We did it, guys.
What were you up to? You were kind of like dead in the eyes earlier. What was up with that?
It was just an off day, you know?
All right.
Just an off day.
We all have those.
But we got through it, didn't we, guys?
I mean, kind of. I was stone, so.
Literally stone.
You look good now.
I guess after like four or five times of basically being dead, mm-hmm. You kind of deserved to relax a little bit inside of yourself.
Yeah. Thank you. What are you guys thinking? What are we going to do today?
So, are we still on our way down to Neverwinter? Is that where we're headed? Yes. Okay.
I think we had talked about getting with the two little gnome girls. And seeing what the magic craziness was going on.
That's right, because that's true. Okay,
that's where we had left off. Whether that's what we want to do, we could just say we don't want to have to deal with it and keep going to Neverwinter. I think we might have said that we would do it though.
Yeah, let's go have a chit chat with the girl who sneezes and makes everything explode.
Sneeze exploder, huh?
Okay.
You don't remember that, Brontar?
Oh yeah, I remember. Like, remember everything.
I remember.
Like I wouldn't remember.
Okay.
It was fantastic. It was fantastic.
All right. So your party eventually taking a few moments to get directions and ask kind of where these two girls that you rescued and kind of saw, or one of them which you saw sneezing. In the middle of this basilisk battle, are located at. You get the directions to their house or to one of their houses. It is, as you approach, it is a single story house, thatched roofed, The sides are made out of this gray, almost gray, like gray stone. It is like every building in this town. It is slightly sunk down into the ground. So the stairs that would that lead to the front door, actually, you have to walk down a few feet into the actual earth to get to the front door. You are all currently standing in front of the You looks very simple. Looks like a normal, just kind of normal house and stuff like that.
I shouldn't go in first. I'm kind of imposing.
Or the we're at the gnome's house.
Yeah.
Sorry, space out there for a second.
I can go in. I'm pretty friendly.
Let's knock on the door. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So Tom walks
up. We have no malicious intent.
Tom walks up and knocks on the door. You hear a voice that say, come from the other side. Just a minute. Few scurried footsteps kind of run around a little bit. And you hear some pans. You hear the sound of like crashing metal, king, bang, bang, down it from inside. And you hear a voice go, fuck it, son of a. arriving at the door, actually a little smaller than you, Tomf, is a gnomish woman wearing a very, very dirty apron. Her hair up in a bun, but like strands are like kind of like just kind of falling down out of it at this point. She wears slight spectacles that are come down to about the tip of her nose, and she looks around and says, catch the sight of you, Tomf, and says, What can I help you with? Who are... And then sees, like, the giant figures behind you and says... And she kind of, like, shrinks even more. She's like, oh, you're quite large. Who are you? How may I help you today?
Hi. I'm Tomf.
Oh, hello. You're not as large as them. Okay.
I am not that big. I'm tiny. I'm fun-sized.
Well, you're taller than me.
A little bit. It's the heels. I wear heels. Really, they're kind of flats. Anyways.
Flat heels.
Well, flat heels, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Bronzor.
Those are called wedges.
wait. Wedges? Wedges. I don't want any wedges. Anyways, off topic. What were we here for again? Oh, yes.
I don't
okay,
know. You're
it.
The one that
we're
knocked on my door.
We're trying to find out
got
why
it.
There's...
what was her name again?
Whose name?
No, but seriously, what was her name again?
Whose name?
The girls?
Yes.
The hell. Nope, that's my
nope,
that's my
that's
weapon.
Your sword. That's your sword.
Started with an H.
Harshnag.
Harshnag?
Nope.
Harshnag. No.
Nope, wait, there you go. It's gotta be somewhere.
Helga?
Nope, those are my notes
Christine
for something.
Or something? I think it's like Christine.
Anyways, we were looking for green hair and black hair.
As you're having this conversation, she looks very confused, and you're trying to figure out some random person's name. But as soon as you mention green hair, she's like, "Oh, you're talking about Sakona." Yes.
Yeah, that's the one. That's the name I just found.
That's
it.
That's it. That's
yes. Sakona.
That's the one.
She's not around here anywhere, is she?
No, not why? Well. Why I don't know.
Right? We're asking
she
you.
Might,
yeah,
she's
we
lying.
Came to you for that.
I thought this is where she was.
No, I've forbidden my daughter to see her or speak with her as of late. She's been quite a bad influence on her, keeping her up.
Oh, bad
way,
news.
Keeping her up way past her bedtime. She's.
I understand.
Marley has been sneaking out in the dead of night. I have no idea where she's going. And ever since her incident a few months back, she hasn't really been right, and she hasn't really been been herself.
Was she the one that was caught up in the
she kind of made a
the
hole.
Rocks in the cave? What
she's,
was she or was she, it
she's the one that fell
or
in
was
the
it
hole.
Scone that was trapped? And Marley, you said your daughter's name was Marley?
Marley, yes. She...
Okay.
Yes, if you... Are you new to the... I don't recognize any of you. Are you new to Huddlestone?
I'm Jessica.
Yes.
I'm a bastard from Huddlestone.
Depends how new you're talking about. Like, I mean, we've been here through a battle, so we kind of saved it.
There was a battle. But
maybe we're just traveled this far.
There was a battle.
We didn't get here today.
There was a battle. What happened?
Some creepy lizard things came out of the ground.
Is Marley all right? At which point she reaches up and grabs Tomf and she's like, "Is Marley all right? Tell me she's all right." And then she gets a giant whiff and she's like,
"I don't know."
And she pushes you away. She's like, "Never mind.
She's fine. Get your hands off my friend. Everything's
we
fine."
We saw her earlier with somebody. Was she with the green hair? I don't. Anyways, I noticed her earlier. She was up near the big statue thing, kind of hanging out there.
Okay.
But when all the lizard things came out, we told her to run because we didn't want her to get hurt. Because we're kind like that. We're nice people, for the most part. Okay.
Wait. Who told her to do this? Who told her to do this?
We, as a collective, told her to go help her.
Okay, just wanted to make sure that it wasn't, one particular person who maybe put his life...
Okay,
his
so Dryden was really the one that said, but I told
well,
you
I mean,
to go,
we
to
don't
go
have
help
to name
out of that Scott, hole.
We don't, it's not important that we name names, but I mean, I did do it.
I would,
so,
it was right. As you say, as you say this and introduce Dryden, you see the small gnomish lady just go into a very deep bow, kind of down onto her knees, and says, and she just goes "Thank you, for thinking of my daughter and keeping
her
safe."
Please get up.
You're welcome.
There's no need for thanks. It's just another day in my life.
We take monetary donations.
we do not take monetary donations. About your daughter.
At which point she's already fumbling with her purse.
Don't
take donations.
Jeez.
She looks
food.
Really confused at this point.
Wink, wink.
Wank.
Yes, come on inside. Oh, it is quite cool. Come on inside. And she shuffles you inside. Yeah. A very simple interior. There's only one. Table in the center of a decent sized table for gnome capacity. The rest of you are this thing is maybe a footstool. it's tiny. A lot of you kind of have to squeeze yourself. Dryden just looks ridiculously scrunched and he's half bent over. He's almost having to kind of crawl in here. Same thing with Jessica at this point. Jessica's your tail might knock a few things around. You see a small iron oven that is kind of positioned in one of the other in the other side, and the smell of some freshly baked bread does kind of waft through the air. The interior very well and warmly lit by a fire crackling in a fireplace on the side. And you see two doors that appear to kind of lead to alternate bedrooms. No actual doors themselves, more just door frames. That lead into two other rooms. She says, "Oh, you are quite a bit larger than the normal company we're used to having, but please make yourself comfortable." And she goes hurriedly busy about it, cutting up some bread, getting some kind of food onto a small tray for you all. Eventually she brings it to the table and sets it down. And she looks over all of you and says, "Well, it's not much, but it's what we have." And she places it on the table.
Thank you. It looks good.
Thank you
it
very
smells
much.
Good. I'm really hungry. I started eating it.
Just saw a bunch of... Literally, my spirit guardian just exploded a lizard from the inside out. By the way, that happened, Rontor. I thought you'd be proud.
I was there.
So I'm not very hungry. I'm not gonna eat right now.
Brontor starts with his silverware from the inside out and starts going to work at what she presented us, because I'm going to start eating. Okay. So, to be polite.
So you kind of dive in and start eating, and the gnomish woman just kind of looks over all of you and says,
"Well, so you haven't seen Marley anywhere apart from just telling her to go run and hide. But you mentioned Sukona was with her."
Maybe. I think. I'm pretty sure she was there. I don't know. A lot was going on. There's a lot of lizard things crawling out of the ground trying to kill us. One of our guys here, actually, he got a little stone. Or turned to stone.
He was a statue.
That sounds terrifying. He appears to be okay now.
Yeah.
Throw a little squished in here.
Not all up there.
Okay is a weird word.
He doesn't seem like he's stone, anyways. Do you have any idea where they went? I would very much like to have Marley back by the time that dinner is ready.
We were kind of hoping you knew. She hasn't been by here?
Not recently, no. She left early this morning. Said she was going out. Said she was going to go. Was going to go exploring. She tends to do that. There's some dwarven ruins, fairly close by, and she sometimes likes to go exploring there and go look around. Being a young woman, I try not to. Her being a young woman, I remember those days, and I try not to. She will go. She will do what she is planning on, or what she needs to do. But if she's hanging out with Sukona, that's not good. That's not a good thing. Sukona has been quite a bad influence on her on Marley.
Where
as
does
well.
She live?
I think she lives on the other side of town. I think her family, they moved here.
It's a pretty small town.
Yeah, they moved here about 4 years ago. They live just on the outskirts, on the very outskirts of town. I've only met her mother and father once. They were very, they weren't all there, if you get my meaning. They were little...
Well, that's rude.
I know that feeling.
Well, they were laying in their bed. They appeared to be very, when they arrived, they came down with a very, very strong sickness that ended up as far as I know, leaving them mostly bedridden. So Kona does what she can, but leaves her quite a lot of free time in order to make sure that, like, besides, you know, getting her own food and. She looks after herself mostly. She's become quite. She's become some semblance of a nuisance to those of us trying to raise our families proper.
If you get word that Marlo is back,
Marley.
But if you get word that she's back. Could you let us know? That'd be a really good. We're just trying to get some stuff sorted out. Some things happened.
What are you trying to get sorted out? What's happened?
Oh, you know the big lizard things that popped out of the ground.
Oh, just okay. Stuff like so that. Just making sure the lizard.
She was there. She saw it. Just want to get details.
I'm kind of curious. So you mentioned that she hasn't been herself lately. What's been happening?
She just seems more reclusive than normal. Seems. A lot less free, carefree than she used to be. She used to go out and just play in the snow and in the town, and was always had a bright smile on her face. But ever since her fall, and she's become much more reclusive and much more almost inside herself. She rarely talks to anybody. I'm lucky if I get a hello out of her in the morning. But she says,
is there anything that has changed in the recent times that would trigger such
maybe sneeze related
feelings or
not that I'm aware of? No. She seems, apart from just seeming very.
About how long ago did this start?
Probably about 3 months ago.
Would you say that she was, like, ill around that time? Maybe sneeze-wise?
Well, that's when her fall happened, but she wasn't.
Could you explain? If you were to describe her sneezes.
Her sneezes? They're cute. They're just kind of more. And she does this little hee-choo type sneeze. It's really about all she does. It's really all they ever are. Nothing spectacular about them.
So, like, you don't see, like, explosions and fireworks and people dying and basilisks turning Dryden into stone when that happens?
Or, like, the earth opening up and, like, falling through it, or, like, turning invisible, or, like...
No, should I?
Or, like, any of that stuff?
Geth whispers over to Dryden, subtle.
And I look at him, and I look at him, not being able to move, and I go, what about this is subtle? What about this situation, like, reeks of subtlety to you?
So, outside, right, real quick, does everybody know that it's this, that the sneezes correlate to it, or was that just me?
I was there when it happened.
You put it together.
But it was linking you put it
together.
The two.
You put it together. I don't remember if you shared that information, though.
I don't think I did. As we were traveling to the house, I let everybody in on what was going on.
Okay, cool.
My thoughts. So that way,
the small gnomish woman just kind of looks up at Ellie and says, "Why are you so interested in her sneezes? Something happened."
I'm a collector of sneezes. I'm an entrepreneur of noses.
An aficionado.
Yes.
Sneeze collector.
A snaz aficionado, is that what you said?
Oh, I thought you were a sneezologist.
I've never heard
dabbled in sneezology, but
I've never heard of
and a sneezeology.
The chairman of the Sneezaroonie Roo Festival every year.
I've never heard of someone like you, but if you say so,
it's a thing.
Thanks for the support, Hunter.
It's a thing.
Make a deception check.
Who, me?
Brontor with advantage because of this everything.
It's a thing. Who are you? Who's he trying to convince?
Hey!
Oh, I'd like to point out that's 3 weeks in a row we've started with that.
We've opened with a natural 20 three weeks in a row.
So it's only down here from it's only downhill from here, guys. She looks just as you're kind of explaining what a sneezologist and all that is, what that does. She's just nodding, her eyes getting wider and wider, and being like, "Might have to get smart." And by the end of your whole like explanation of what it is, you see her eyes kind of like darting around. She's like, "Might have to get Marlee into that." And she's just nodding. You asked about Marlee's fall. A few months back, about 3 months back, she fell, went missing for hours, and we found her deep in a snow crevasse where she seemed to have fallen through some of the snow that had fallen earlier that day down into a deep ice, like ice crevasse down into farther down.
That must have been terrifying.
It was terrifying for me. It took us the better part of a few hours to get her out, but she came out, seemed fine. No, just apart from a few minor scrapes and bruises, but ever since then she's been more withdrawn.
Did she mention anything that happened when she was in the crevasse?
She don't remember anything. She just seemed to have a large bump on her head. Her eyes were her eyes were wide when we brought her out, and almost as though she had gone through some form of ordeal. But I mean, falling into a crevasse and being stuck down there for hours, so it's not a normal occurrence around here, and it's very terrifying, especially for a young lady.
I could imagine.
Well, for anyone, actually.
That sounds like a terrible ordeal.
If you see Marlee, please tell her that I am worried about her and that I wish she would come home.
We will let her know if we find her.
Would you like to come with us while we go looking for her?
Oh, jeez.
As much as I would love to, I do have some...
Tom will carry you on his back. He told me himself.
I mean... I'm used to carrying the team anyways.
I don't want to have to protect someone while we're out on the road, guys.
It's not until, like...
We're not going on the road. We're going around the corner.
It's not until late night that
I could probably carry you over that way.
It's not until late. It's not until, like, the sun goes down and she's not home. That's when I start getting worried. But
I don't know.
If there was an attack earlier today and these basilisks you speak of attacked the village, then just... let her know that I want to know that she's safe.
We will do that.
You want to know that she, okay, yep, we got that.
Let her know that you know that she's safe. Got it.
I want to know that she's safe.
Right.
So you want to know that she knows that you know that she's safe.
I just want to know that everyone knows that what we know is the things that everyone needs to know.
So if you know that we'll keep her safe, she'll know that we know that you want her to be safe.
This is getting very confusing for me, but yes, I think I think we understand each other.
We're on the same page.
Sort of, but okay. Over the course of the next few minutes, you finish up your food. If you have any other questions you would like to ask the small gnomish lady.
Do you have any more food?
By the way, the food was divine.
What's the situation here? Is there larger than normal bathroom somewhere?
Yes. My home is one of the smaller homes, but the sudden bear is accommodating for all races and sizes. You should be able to find accommodations there.
Are we getting a room? Are we going to get a room or are we going to head there? Because someone's got to pee.
I don't think we rested after.
That's what I'm talking about.
Did we rest?
That's the word that I wanted to use. Rest.
Let's take a rest.
I'm still pretty stoned. I could take a rest. But I'm...
All right. So, you get a little bit more food from the gnomish lady. You eventually head back to the sudden bear. Jessica does her dragonborn business. And
I had to pee the entire battle, guys. You don't even know. Like, really, I only called Bean out because I couldn't fight, or else I would have peed myself.
As we were leaving, by the way, I left 10 gold. For the gnome.
Okay, cool. Okay, you eventually make your way back to the sudden bear, and you guys taking a long rest? You taking a short rest? What are you doing?
Long rest.
Yeah.
I'm good with doing a long rest. The only thing is I want to try and get with somebody to see if they can keep an eye out for Marley and Skona. Is it Skona or Sukona?
Sukona.
Sukona.
Sukona. Sukona. Sukona.
Yeah, just to kind of keep an eye out for them.
I'll keep an eye out because I've got to tinker with some stuff anyway.
Okay. I don't need to rest at all.
Aren't you freaking lucky that you don't have spells that you have to recharge?
Yeah, it's pretty great. Are you sure we didn't rest already? Like, why are my hit points all the way back up?
You might have got healed.
I don't know.
You tell me.
I don't know.
I don't need to rest. So I'd like to wander about and see what I can find out. Like, look, just keep an eye out. Kind of use a little tracking. Because I kind of know which direction they ran off.
Just in case anything popped off.
You weren't here. This town is walking distance. Like, three minutes front to back. Like, this is a very small town.
That's why when
the gnome said, oh, on the outskirts of town somewhere, I was like, you should know where that is, though, right?
So, she's informed that Jessica healed you.
For us tiny folk, it's a little bit longer walk.
Little birdie just told me that it was Jessica that healed you. That's why you're good.
Jessica. Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did do that.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. Okay, so we'll say over the course of over the next 8 hours.
I used all my spells.
We'll say over the course of the next 8 hours, the rest of you take a long rest, like intentionally, like bandage up your wounds. You're restored to full health. You take your, you get all your spells back. Dryden, you're not doing any physical exertion at the moment, so unless other things happen. While they're doing that, you walk around. You get you got the instructions to Sukona's house, you manage to walk over in that direction, and you do kind of scope it out a little bit. It looks very similar to the gnomish house that you just left. It is set farther into the ground. This one looks a little bit more ramshackled. The roof does not look as well maintained. It looks like there's a few potential, like, very thin spots, almost like there might even be a few holes that come up, or that might be, like, about to happen in the roof. There is no smoke coming out of the chimney, but you do find the house you believe to be Sukona's, and the ones that the direction is pointing you in that direction of, while still continuing to ask people to be on the lookout for Marley and Sukona as you kind of work through the town.
Okay. what time is it? I'm assuming it's like the dead of night.
This is like by the time you get over there, probably about five in the evening at this point.
Oh, I'm knocking on the door.
Okay. Knock on the door. Wait a little bit. No response.
So it's a little tiny door?
Yeah, it's a little tiny door.
Okay, I knock on the tiny door again. Maybe a little bit harder.
A little softer.
And then just right. No. No, not no.
So
answer.
just this type sound. No answer.
What are the chances I can lift the roof off this house and look down into it?
You guys try.
Why?
I'd like to pick the roof up.
Just
roof
open
up
the door if you want to go in.
Okay, it's strong. Too small. Strength check. Strength check.
Oh my gosh.
You're not there. You're not there. You're resting.
I love it.
Wow. Yeah, we're sleeping.
I'd like to stick to the shadows and watch what Blue's doing here.
Are you resting or are you tinkering?
Dryden?
I'm going to be tinkering at some point in the night.
Okay. Tinkering in the shadows?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that what they're calling it nowadays?
So Geth, you're following then. Okay, I gotcha. So you're not taking a long rest yet. Okay.
Like, what Geth the fuck is this guy doing in the shadows.
So Dryden, you find like a kind of a portion of the roof, you get your fingers underneath it. Like you actually end up ripping like a good portion of the roof off, and you're just like a good like solid fourth of the roof just comes completely off at this point, and you're just holding it, and it's like kind of like, and you're just kind of holding it up in the air, just kind of waves flimsily. A few villagers look over, you'd be like, "Oi, what are you doing? What are you doing up there? What are you doing to the roof? Are you trying to destroy the house?"
No, I'm fixing a divot.
It's fixing a divot.
Make a persuasion roll.
Space Jam.
So glad you got that.
That was what I rolled.
Nice.
They're just like, all right. And they keep walking. Like, all right, just be careful. There's some sick people in there. And the pair just keeps walking along.
Does he loudly tell the rest of the town exactly what I'm doing word for word?
Nope, just keeps walking.
He's fixing a divot!
As you look into... As you're currently holding this flimsy portion of the roof, that's mostly just straw, and it's starting to kind of, like, fracture and not necessarily stay as, like, together as you'd expect it to. You glance down and look into it, and you see a very similar laid out type of like kind of living common room area that you just left and that you were currently really scrunched into. The only difference on this one is as you're kind of looking in it, everything is very, very dusty. There appears to only be like, while there's no table, there is a fireplace in the corner that looks like it has like the small remnants of a fire that's probably gone out probably a few hours ago. It's like just a little bit of smoke is kind of coming off of it. And you see also in the other predominant feature of this room is that there is a two-person bed in it. And you see two people currently sleeping, or currently laying down in the bed at this point.
So there are people in there then. Like that is, okay. And are they, what kind of people are they? We deal with a lot of different people.
Yeah, they look like two gnomes.
Why does that matter, Blue?
It's actually a viable question.
These people.
What do you mean, these people? There were two gnomes laying in this bed, a male and a female, from what you can see. One, both have very stock gray, like gray hair, and the man is like balding on top, a very not well kept beard. Adorns his face. The female, her hair is very wispy, does like not look full at all. They're currently like tucked in, and they're just laying there, eyes shut. You see their chests rise and fall as they breathe, sleeping.
Oi!
No response.
I poke one of them.
No response.
Okay, I set the roof down. Can I still see the people walking away?
Yeah. Yeah, you can see.
Okay,
it.
I set the roof down and turn around and go, "Oi!"
they turn around and they're like, one of them goes like, "What? What do you want?"
Okay, quick question for you. All right, real quick. Sorry, I'm new to this whole thing. The whole, you know, fixing divots thing. While fixing that divot, I saw a couple people inside that home that appeared to be sleeping. That's normal. Wasn't being weird or anything. They asked me to fix the divot. You can ask them if you can wake them up. Do you know how to wake them up?
Poke them?
I did poke them, actually, yell and they them? Didn't wake up. I did yell at them, and they didn't wake up. Should we, like, help them?
Gina, do you know any other way to wake people up? Throw some water on them?
Please don't pee on them. Please don't pee on them. Come
you
on,
see, guys. you see the other gnome currently look down at his ruin for a moment, look up, and think. Then he's like, nah. He's like, yeah, that's the only way I know how to wake people up. It's just throw water, poke them, yell at them. Normally, Gina gets kind of annoyed at me when I start yelling or poking her. And she's like, damn right I do.
Boil them, mash them, stick them in a stew.
So, do you guys have like a bucket of water I could have to throw on these people?
They kind of look around. And they kind of look around and it's like, no, there's a bucket right there. And then the fountain and the water spigot's over there.
We're talking about the life and death of these people. I need you to give me a bucket of water now.
Make an intimidation check. They look very frightened, and like you see them like kind of like go like, all right, jeez, we're okay. And they like and like well, the guy goes and runs and grabs a bucket and like starts hurrying after Gina, and like Gina's like currently already at the pump. He's like, hurry, and like starts pumping the water. It eventually comes up and fills the bucket full of water. Guy runs it back over to you and says, here, just don't. Don't pee on them. Don't do anything. Just here's the bucket of water.
I'm not gonna do anything. I'm worried about the well-being. So I grab the bucket, walk back over with the one hand because I'm feeling strong.
Yeah.
I lift the roof bag up, and I take the bucket, and I dump I pour just a teeny bit of water on one of their foreheads. Okay. Just a teeny bit.
Okay.
Is there a page in the book for pouring water on people?
No response.
He's looking up the rules.
No response.
Volume of water cubed.
A little bit of trickle.
I dump the bucket of water on one of the
people. Gets all over both of them. They are both now absolutely soaked. Chest raises and falls, rises and falls. Still sleeping. There's a little bit of a sputter as they're. As like their lungs kind of exhale the water, like the little bit of water that jumped into their.
You decided they were choking on the water, not me.
Still sleeping, just raises, falls.
Okay, turn around. Oi! He didn't wake him up.
Okay. As you turn around, you come face to face with face-to-face with another individual with slightly pointed ears. You hear this sound, and you turn around, and you're face-to-face with your compatriot of Geth.
Hi, Geth!
What are you doing?
I think they're dead, but they're breathing.
I think I can wake them up.
If you shoot them, then again, idea, Geth. If we line them up, you can kill them both with one bullet.
That's true, I could. I don't think I want to kill him, though.
Ah, damn, all right.
So I unload my pistol of all the bullets in it, but I load it up with gunpowder, and I'm just going to fire a blank. I'm going to reach my hand with the gun into the house and then shoot it off.
Okay, you do. Let's out a very deafening sound. They're still sleeping.
All right, well, I'm out.
You're out. Do you know anything about, like, I've dumped water on him. I poked him.
At this point, you look over. At this point, a voice cuts through the air. It took me way too long to find that word. Cuts through the air and says, "What do you think you're doing? What have you done to my house?"
I'm fixing a divot.
You whirl around, you spin around, and you see walking towards you, a very small gnomish girl with bright green hair. Very, very vibrant and dark emerald eyes, who is currently staring at you. And she walks up to you and says, "What are you doing? My parents are sleeping in there."
I set the roof down, and I walk over, and basically I kind of like plop down on the ground. Yep. And like a non-intimidating, like almost like on your level, like let's just have a conversation kind of thing.
It's not anywhere close to her level, but yeah, I got you. You kind of.
But it's more than standing up and being right. Like, I'm a lot bigger than you.
Right, I got you. You kind of like plop down like to, yeah, I got you. You're good.
I will stay standing up behind Dryden.
Okay.
And cross my arms.
I do one swift motion with my arm and knock him out at the knees.
strength check versus guess dexterity check.
Uh-oh.
Oh. Not good.
I never win these interactions. I'm really happy about this.
Geth is just prone back on like on his back at this point. Just as the air kind of gets knocked out of him. You sit up a little bit. It's going to hurt. But you're now sitting as well. Once again, the girl looks up at you, Dryden, and says, "What do you think you're doing? That's my house. My parents are very sick. They must maintain their rest."
Could you tell me what's wrong with them? Because I wanted to talk to them to find you, frankly, and they're not waking up. And then we'll discuss why I was trying to find you.
They've been sleeping like that for a few weeks now, and I feed them as best I can. I make sure they get water and they stay hydrated, but our healers have said that it is our healers have said that is as long as the fever doesn't come back, we should be okay.
Sakona, right?
Who's asking?
Me.
And you are?
None of your damn business.
Shut up, Geth. I'm Dryden. This is Geth, the least intimidating person you'll ever meet, using no inflection in his voice.
I want my gun still unloaded of bullets, but since I'm behind Dryden, I'm going to put it right next to his ear and fire off another blank.
Okay, so it's going to take you a moment or two to actually re-put the gunpowder back in there and get it reset since you're using just your pistol. So it takes you a moment to do that. Dryden, you see Geth working with something behind you. But you're make a perception check.
Periphery.
Geth is messing with something by you. You're more concerned about the gnomish girl in front of you at this point. And she says, she gives this small awkward little curtsy, and it's like, "It's a pleasure to meet both of you.
I don't appreciate your ruse."
"I don't appreciate you ripping off half of my house in order to try and talk to my parents."
"That's fair. Have a seat. Let's have a conversation."
She stands there, kind of crosses her arms, and just taps her feet a little bit and says,
"What do you want to talk to me about?"
"I want to know why they're sleeping, and I want to know when I'm going to have tinnitus for the rest of the night."
"They're sleeping because they're sick. Our healers have tried everything that they know, and that they are currently in some form of coma, as far as they can tell. They told the healers to check on them every single day. Make sure that they ask me to make sure that they get water and some food that I can get down their throats. And apart from that, they'd refuse to wake."
"When did this happen?"
"Well, they've been sick ever since we got here, about a few years ago, and just comes in waves, sometimes hits them, but never to this extent before."
"Now what happens when you get sick?"
"I don't get sick."
You don't, like, sneeze or anything?
I sneeze, but that's just because I have wicked things up my nose, and that gets quite annoying at times, but nothing happens. Why?
Well, I'm concerned about your friend Marley.
Is Marley all right?
Well,
She ran off from me when those things attacked and you told us to run.
Mm-hmm.
She ran off we made it a few yards before her eyes grew wide as she stared at me, and she ran away screaming like I was some form of monster to her. Haven't been able to track her down since.
She fell in a ice chasm a while back, right?
Aye, she did.
Mm-hmm. Do you happen to take a look at that ice chasm? When they found her?
I mean, I was one of the people helping to bring her up, but I didn't go down into it, if that's what you're asking.
Mm. Have you guys been back there? Has she wanted to go back there?
She doesn't want to go back there. Reminds her too much of that painful memory.
Right.
So, any other questions?
Well, earlier, do you remember me from the whole basilisk incident out there?
Aye, and thank you for saving our lives. It was helpful. It was...
Oh, it was nothing. But I couldn't help but notice one of you was invisible. I couldn't see your friend there. So what was that all about? Does that happen a lot?
Invisible.
Oh god, the dice.
I'm invisible. Did something happen?
You were right there. You held her hand.
And there were giant lizards right next to us. I was a little preoccupied.
You didn't recognize, like, even acknowledge the fact that she was completely invisible when you ran off.
I want to roll for insight.
Hold on, I actually have to think about how that played out in the last game.
I literally made them hold hands.
That's right, you did. Sorry, this is what happens when the DM forgets things. Hi.
How is it that Dryden is remembering things the DM isn't remembering?
Dryden's real smart.
Keeping him honest. Yeah, yeah.
That's a good player. Like, right there,
good
the
job,
hell
guys.
Does this not know this?
That's a good play right there. Watch your DMs, guys. So
that happens, guys. Good job.
She thinks about it for a moment. It's like, oh yeah, that's right. She was oh, because you, yep, you had us hold hand, yep. Okay, I'm remembering that now. What was your question again?
Did you notice that she was invisible?
I just assumed it was part of the... I found it strange, but wasn't really trying to ask questions to figure out why she was invisible at that time.
Do you never came up? Does she go invisible from time to time? Is it a thing that happens?
No.
Okay. Let me pose it to you this way. If Geth here were to go invisible, good on you, man. That's awesome. Congratulations. But if he were to go invisible, I'd want to know more about how, why, and for what purpose.
Well, now that you talk about it, there has been some weird things happening around Marley recently. Random creatures have been popping up when we're together, and there have been oftentimes random explosions or sparks that have been going off near us, not directly on top of us or anything, but just near us. And we normally she gets scared and runs away, and I go over and investigate him, and when I get over there, nothing's there, nothing's happened.
It's kind of peculiar. Now, when would you say that this stuff started?
Ago, maybe.
Hmm.
At least that's the first time I was noticing it.
Has anyone else gotten hurt from this?
Not that I know of, no. I mean, we've had some... And there's been some weird incidents has happening recently. Water completely freezing over in the middle of the day. There was that roof that caught fire, but luckily no one was hurt. There was a cave-in down at the dwarven ruins. What does this have? What does this have to do with Marley?
Do you know where she is now?
No, as I said, after she became visible again, she saw me. Her eyes widened. She got very scared and ran in the direction of the ruins, and I went to go look for her and couldn't find her.
We need to find her. So we're going to have to go look for her? All right.
Well, do what you want, and I've got to check on my parents at this point.
I understand that. I hand her 200 gold and say, I'm sorry I couldn't fix your roof. You'll have to hire someone else to do it.
She looks down at the gold and says, all right. I know some people who would be more than happy to help fix the roof, and she pockets the gold.
It's probably way more gold than she needed, but I did throw water on her parents, and Geth covered the entire inside of the house with gunpowder.
what's gunpowder?
It's just this magical stuff that's really... Yeah, it's fine. Just don't breathe too much of it.
At which point... Right next to your head, Dryden. Boom! Your eardrum just gets blown out, and Sukuna like reaches her hands up and goes like, ah, what? Get out of here.
With pleasure. I stand up and walk away.
You walk away.
Like how in the real world you can't keep a straight face.
Oh. Mop.
So. Sukuna looks at you just a little meaved, her ears still ringing, and she's like trying to mess with him. Geth is walking away at this point.
Whoa. Okay. Well, I think we're all set here. Can I help you with anything else?
Nope. I'm good.
Perhaps you need like a wall torn down off your
hand.
House or
her hand just goes up and says, I'm good, and she's still like messing with one of her ears, and she walks into her house at this point. You hear the door kind of close behind her. All of you eventually make your way back to the Sudden Bear. If that's unless you guys are going someplace else. Dryden and Geth.
No, I'll head back.
I think it's time to head back.
Okay, you guys head back. You meet up with the rest of your party. You all eventually complete a long rest. You can talk over the long rest if you feel so compelled to. If you have anything that you would like to accomplish before you set out on your...
I need to put fuses inside of my grenades.
I was going to say, it's getting late in the evening. So anything you guys would like to do before the evening rest happens?
I need to put fuses in my grenades.
Okay.
I've got rope.
Have the rest of us been just like... resting the rest of the day, the whole day?
Unless you guys want to do something, what do you want to do?
No, I was just asking. While they were doing that,
you guys were resting. Yes, you guys said you wanted to take a long rest.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm just going to make some more arrows in the meantime.
Okay, cool. Geth, make a tinker's check. Just make a regular tinker's check.
We waking up anytime soon?
Yeah, you guys are awake at this point by the time they get back.
Blood curse is back to full health.
Follow up question: did we know whether or not there was a leather worker here?
Leather worker? Asking around, you can find one. Yeah. There's a blacksmith, so probably about as close as you're gonna get. It's not quite a leather worker specifically. That one you're probably gonna look into probably a larger city. There's no one in this town that this isn't like a like armory type town. I mean, you can probably find someone maybe, but this is more like bare bones, try to survive. The only reason there's a blacksmith is to like help make like portions for the tools that they need. And since it is primarily a mining town, there's not really a ton of like fighting that they do. A lot of their resources come from like the mines that they work in and the minerals that they export.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Nah, I'm not gonna worry about it. I was just curious.
All right, Geth, you, okay, so you're okay. So you have rope. You have,
Yeah, because I've got the grenades, the two grenades that I made, but I didn't make a fuse.
I was gonna say you have like, so you're putting basically, you're just making like a fuse thing. Okay, gotcha. Yeah. Cool. Okay. Yeah. No. Easily. Oh no, that's easy enough. You take like some tar and wax and just kind of like put the cap over, put rope in. Yeah, more than fine.
Sweet.
Okay. Cool. So you has you had two grenades. You had two of those grenade things. So write down two functional grenades? Question mark.
All right.
Okay.
Asterisk.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. All right. So you you take the rest of the day, pretty much relax, do what you need to do. All of you are restored to full health. You are restored to full spells. Guess you're able to craft those and still manage to get your full rest in. Wake up the next morning. Day is yours.
So, guys, it sounds like Marlee has wandered off to the dwarven mines nearby.
Okay.
So,
do we want to go?
I'm saying let's go to it. This girl's dangerous, and not saying it'll come to it, but she might need to get put down.
Or saved.
Or put down.
Or put
down. I'll hit her with a hammer.
Wow.
We're getting crazy. Okay.
Wow.
All right. I guess we're doing this so I can go protect this girl from you guys.
I guess figuratively too.
I think we got to put Brontor back down for another nappy poo. Someone is grumpy. Grumpy Gus over here. All right.
No, I'm good, man. Let's do this.
You probably shouldn't kill her because, A, that's inhumane, and we're good people. And, B, she could probably help us, you know, fix this. What if it's not her? What if it's something in the town, you know?
I'm not saying we'll kill her.
Everything around her until we get to her, and then if it comes to it, we'll kill her.
Okay. Yeah.
Why even plan for this?
So you
plan for everything.
You guys are having this conversation as you're making your way to the dwarven ruins and the dwarven ruins. I'll say. You eventually make it to after getting directions kind of to them, and you find this portion of the like it takes you out of the town, a little farther down the Ten Trail that you guys have currently been. That you guys have been currently traversing on your way towards Neverwinter. Eventually, it comes to kind of like a more rockier area, and as you're descending, because now you guys are now descending a little bit from Huddlestone. As you're descending, you hear this boom, 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 boom from behind you, and you glance back and you see this large humanoid figure following after you. A giant hand waves down at you and says,
"You guys didn't tell me you were leaving."
Frankly, I didn't think you were still here.
We're leaving!
I thought about you, Harsh. I was thinking about you.
Harsh, there. Good to see you, pal.
Good to see you, too. I saw you yesterday.
Yeah, I mean, hey.
We meant we
were coming by to get you.
Hey, I like you, man. So
you guys were walking.
Every time I see you
guys were walking the opposite direction than I was sitting. I was sitting over on the other side of town.
You know, little people like us, we're just crazy like that and lose direction all the time, right?
And you got great patience.
he kind of just like nods and shrugs and just kind of keeps walking.
I keep my laughter to myself.
Eventually, you guys continue walking down. As you're walking down, you end up noticing that the cloud cover in this area is getting a lot thicker, and you kind of like end up descending kind of through a few clouds. You can like still see trees and everything. Like just it's like you're in a very, very thick fog right now.
In a very thick fog. Eventually, you kind of get. Eventually, as you're kind of walking through this large, a shadow kind of looms out from in front of you, and you see a 40 foot tall, by 25 by about 30 foot wide opening, that huge archway. Parts of it that look crumbled and torn and like kind of not torn off, but like just kind of crumbled and like completely out of repair. This large archway that just kind of goes into the side of the mountain that you guys have been currently walking on. You glance around, you do see some dwarven runes on, like, kind of marking the sides of this archway. And that's where you guys are currently at.
Looks like a cool archway.
Can I decipher any of the runes?
Huge.
Yeah. You see.
You have a map?
Nope. No map.
A visual person.
The map of your mind.
Archway. Okay. Runes. All right. We're good.
I can put you back on the north map.
Oh my god, that's so much.
So.
I like it.
You're descending down through the area. You glance in, and. Deciphering some of the runes. Yeah, you glance up and you see basically it translates roughly to welcome esteemed guests of Clan Zala.
That's me.
Friend and enter.
Clan Zala.
I'm Clan Zala.
Anybody know about Clan Zala?
Do I know about Clan Zala from my religion studies?
History check.
Do I know anything about Clan Zala from my time in the pubs?
History check.
As a slut.
Do I know anything about Clan Zala from my work with the hermit in the swamps?
It's the first two history checks I've taken, so...
So I don't.
I do know about Clan Wu-Tang, though.
Yes, they are very skilled with their mouths, actually.
And it's nothing to fuck with.
They are very good.
They are gifted
wordsmiths.
They are an esteemed college of bards. Their home college is somewhat of a mystery and somewhat has been lost to legend. Some even think it is legend, but there still are bards that wander around have been known to come from that college.
I met a man of many methods, and he told me about the Clan Wu-Tang.
At Wu-Tang Financial, they do diversify their bonds.
So, Dryden and Jessica, you guys, surprisingly, you both know of Clan Zala. They were a clan that existed before the spell plague. They ended up no one has really heard from them for quite some time. And as people have kind of like gone and looked at where their structures and their mines used to be, they have found them all in just complete and absolute ruin. They used to be very, very some of the best metal workers among dwarfdom, but ever since their disappearance, it's been a huge blow to some of the dwarven iron workers. However, there are other clans that have been brought up to fill their shoes.
Gift nods in agreement.
Gotcha. Cool. So,
I know about these things. That's all I
know.
Say.
Yes. Okay. I remember.
I don't know anything
or
useful,
I'm sorry.
But yeah. I know some things.
I get it. Yep.
Okay. Cool.
These are things and that we know of.
Yes.
Right, Gav?
Got it.
I take you
guys. All right, let's go.
All right. So, you guys walk in. Cool. You're right. You walk in, and it is actually surprisingly large enough for Harshnag to actually follow you in and actually move pretty freely
Our friend giant gets to come.
He hears you.
Harshneck, this will be funny.
He hears you.
Put this rope around your neck. Just hold. I'm gonna walk you in like you're my pet.
Harsh. I was joking.
He hears you say that. He hears you say that and says, "I am nobody's pet."
If anything, we're like your little puppy dogs running around your feet.
Come on, just put this rope around your neck.
As you say that,
as
you say that, Jessica, he like you see his shoulders kind of slump a little bit more, and he gets really reserved and just really quiet.
I'm sorry. Did you have a pet puppy be lost?
No answer.
Damn it, Rams.
Just keeps walking.
Harshneck, can I sit on your shoulder going into this new city? I'm kind of scared.
He just keeps walking.
Oh, you guys. Aww. What did you do to him?
Harsh, I'm sorry. Big H.
He's such a good friend. And now he's sad.
His name's Harshnag.
Too far, Jessica.
Harsh,
the harder Jessica tries to be nice, the meaner she is. She's killing everyone. She's pissing off the only ally we've made this whole time.
Like, man, now he's never gonna fight with us again.
You walk about 100 yards into this very, very beautiful, just grand, although in somewhat rumbling and ruined state, beautiful dwarven mined and crafted great hall. There are pillars that just go from floor to ceiling. It is very dark in here, so some of you light some torches to kind of be able to see where you're actually walking. Brontor, you especially need it, but you've managed to kind of walk in and see. And even with the limited light, it does, like, you are impressed with the dwarven architecture and their building capabilities. For some of you, this is the first time ever seeing very well made. Or even at all just dwarven architecture. You keep walking and you glance about, and it's a very wide open space. The pillars just run. Think kind of like Tolkien's Farthendor.
Rivendor?
No.
Helm's Deep.
That, no.
No, I know.
I hate all
Mordor.
Of you. No, it's Fellowship of the Rings, where the Balrog is. I'm failing as a nerd right now.
I know what you're talking about.
Moria.
Yeah, think like the Moria. Like
Moria.
Like,
what's that? Tolkien. What's a Moria?
Think of that. That's
like
kinda,
what?
Think of that. Like there's like it's there's a lot
higher than Alessia.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Gitch. You think of that as kind of like
Gitch knows
as you're walking. You eventually reach the other side though. And you do see there is a it is just flat stone. It's just flat stone. You kind of walk around the entire perimeter of the room, and you find, apart from the entrance that you walked in, there is just flat stone everywhere.
Hmm.
Do we hear drums?
No.
Drums in the deep.
Can we tell what the space is used for?
Seems like a great hall. Seems like a gathering place of some form.
Perception check.
Yeah, go for it. You do find it odd though that there's no other doors or no other entrances apart from the one you entered.
Perception.
I'm looking. I'm not good at perception. Perception.
Okay.
Prescription.
Tomfin Brontor. Tomfin Brontor.
Yeah, I can't
keen eyes.
As both of you are kind of just walking around, you do catch one portion of the wall that looks a little less dirty than the rest. You go.
Hey, guys.
Yes.
No, I was gonna wait for the DM.
No, I'm letting you go.
No, go ahead.
You were saying something, Brontor?
We'll wait.
I'm listening.
I don't know what I see yet.
Okay. You walk up to it, and what you see is. The thing that mainly catches, like, the entire rest of the walls are just absolutely smooth, but this one portion has this beautiful carving in it of what appears to be like dwarves and doing mine, a very beautiful depiction of just kind of like what you gather is kind of the history of Clan Zala. But the thing that catches your attention is that
there's one dwarf that currently, like, there's one dwarf that's currently standing there, and in the very center of his chest, there is just a large hole. That looks, it's about...
Giggity.
It's about... It's his chest. It's about,
Sorry, I thought I was mute.
It's probably about a foot wide, about a foot in diameter, all the way across, and it kind of extends into darkness, from what you can see.
Hey, Tom, do you want to stick your arm in that? See what happens?
Want to is a strong word. But I stick my hand in there.
I'll do it if Tom doesn't want to do it.
Okay, so Tom, if you reach your hand in there...
Curiosity has the best of me.
You feel at the very... You have to kind of, like, stretch, and you... Your arm goes all the way up to your shoulder. Like, you reach your arm in there, and you feel... your hand actually is able to grasp onto a... what it feels like an iron rod that's sticking in there. And you kind of, like, feel up and down. It runs all the way up and down the hole. Tut. And as you kind of mess with it, you feel it turn a little bit. You feel a little bit of give.
Okay. After holding it for a second, I just start screaming at the top of my lungs. Just like, ah!
Okay.
Jessica rushes over. What's wrong? Do you need healing?
There was a rat that crawled over my hand. It scared me. We're good. I think. I don't know. Maybe it was a spider. I don't know.
Spiders as big as rats?
Correct me if I don't know very much about the gnomish people. I thought that you were a man. Am I misunderstanding that?
I don't know. To me, gnomish people are horrendous people, but halflings are absolutely wonderful people. Halflings, I love halflings.
Whatever, halflings.
But yeah, gnomes are the worst.
I thought you were a halfling man.
Yeah. I know how you feel, Jessica. And I just turn away.
Okay. Well, you still have your arm stuck in the hole at this point. And
I know. I turn away from her.
Okay, gotcha.
I just, like, laid and get this perception again.
I'm like, so Tom, what was in the hole?
Apparently a rat.
Feels like a large
tiny
rod.
Baby screaming.
There's a little bit of give to it. It, like, feels like it might rotate.
Can you tug on it?
It's kind of loose. Let me jiggle it. And so I'm going to try and turn it.
Okay. You turn it, it turns a full 90 degrees, and you hear this. Brontor, make a dexterity check.
Uh-oh.
I was just going to suggest that you probably check for traps, but you made me mad.
You called me a gnome.
12?
Y'all are just tiny people.
Okay. Brontor, you feel this Tom, you feel this unbelievable sharp pain.
Did I need to make the dexterity save?
Did I say Brontor?
You did say Brontor.
Sorry, Tom, make a dexterity check.
All right, let me make a dexterity saving throw or dexterity check?
Dexterity saving
Brontor's throw. Just on the side being dexterous.
Yeah, he's just being super dexterous.
Okay. Whoa, that lingered on that table.
Yeah, there's 5, 4, 2.
Okay, so Tom, you feel the click, and you sense something's not right. You feel the shift in air, and you pull your hand out just in time to feel this, or just as you see, just coming all throughout the hole, just these metal spikes that just jut out from the all edges of the hole. Your hand manages to dart out. But and you watch as they retract back into, like, small slits along the side of this little cavern. But you do hear this lot. As they retract, you hear this as you glance forward and you see a large door, as tall from ceiling to ground, just open or begin to slowly open inward, farther deeper, open farther in.
I walk up to Tom and I pat him on the back basically as hard as you'd possibly imagine I could and go, nice job!
Tom just goes sliding into the ground, almost like forward into the actual room itself.
Thanks.
That's good. It's good work.
It feels good to get hit on the back really hard, doesn't it?
Dryden, make a dexterity saving throw.
What?! Why me? Ooh, I'm having a good day today.
As you duck down to kind of help Tomf back up, you feel this just right over your head of just air. You kind of glance back. And you see Harshnag currently just reaching back with reaching, just awkwardly scratching his head.
I laugh. I go, that would have been really funny. And it was funny that you missed.
Harshnag just kind of looks like isn't even making eye contact. He's just like, I don't know what you're talking about. And he just starts walking in the door.
I turn to go, Harshnag! Just to get his attention.
Yeah.
Then I slowly hold up a bro fist.
He brings the giant size fist down. Like your fist is like where my finger is, and like the rest of his fist is just entirely encompassing. Like it's just like boop, pulls back.
I think that I have to meet the fist, just so I leave the crowd.
Yeah, you jump up a little bit. Kaboonk. Get there. You guys continue walking down this corridor through the doors. The doors stay open. Nothing crazy. Your entire party walks down. I need for everyone to make perception checks.
I got a seven. What the
my
fuck?
Perception eyes.
I always think the dice on the screen when we all do it is mine, and I was like, yeah.
All right, Tom.
It's like a 20.
Geth and Brontor.
Me and Rams are just picking our noses over.
Yeah.
Geth's just picking our noses. Tom, like, oh, yeah.
Tom, Brontor, and Geth, you guys, all of you, as you were walking farther and farther in, as all three of you are walking farther in, and as your entire party is, something catches all three of your ears kind of almost simultaneously. You hear what sounds
drums.
Like, no, you sound, no, you hear the sounds of like echoing what almost sounds like cries or kind of like sniffles. And it's just like, and it just seems to be echoing from farther in.
You guys hear that?
Yeah, it sounds like someone's here.
Is Tomf crying again?
Jessica and Dryden, you guys are carrying a conversation with Harshnag at this point.
I'm sorry, Harsh. I didn't mean to insult Poppy.
Geth Tomf, you hear that?
Yeah, I did hear that. It sounds like we've got company.
Sounds like a.
Yeah, let's.
I don't know what it sounds like.
Let's slow it down a little bit. We're gonna try to figure out what.
Put
this
my
is.
Hand on the on my gun. Mm-hmm.
Harshnag, where's the best stew you've ever gotten? Where was that?
he informs you it's someplace in Waterdeep, called the Laughing Lamia.
Writing that down. What was it called again?
The Laughing Lamia.
Laughing what?
Lamia.
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 Yeah. So you guys continue walking in. You get a little closer and keep at this point, all of you can hear these kind of like echoing, like kind of sniffles, and like it does kind of sound as if like somebody's crying a little bit. As you look forward, you see another large archway in the gloom. But this time, everyone hears a voice kind of come echoing back at you. I can't go on
like this. This wasn't supposed to happen.
A second voice enters your ears and comes echoing down and says,
"It's all right. It's all right. They will understand. You have been my friend for so long." Is this really the best way? Is this the best thing that I can do for everybody? Yes, it is. It's the best thing you can do. They will understand.
You guys get closer and closer, or continue getting closer, and you hit the archway. You glance into this very large room. It's approximately 80 feet by about 60. There are two staircases that kind of lead up on your sides, about halfway into the room, that lead up to small, like, ledges that you can see. Farther back, the pillars line the middle of this this kind of walkway, this hallway. But you glance farther in and you see two small girls who are currently, like, one is kneeling down on the ground, or both are kneeling on the ground. One is, like, kind of like behind the other girl with her hands just kind of on her on the other one's shoulders. And as you're watching this and, like, kind of listening to this, you do get a little bit, you can see that one girl has very brown hair. The other one, her hair is a very stark and bright green.
I grab Jessica's hand and bust through the doors and try to get her to, hey, you got to help this girl right now.
Okay, as you run into that area, because there's no doors really to bust through.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
It's just
as dramatically as possible.
You rush through. You see the girl with the green hair kind of glance up and says,
Marley, if you're going to end it, end it now. You don't want to go on farther, any much more like this.
I say, Marley, wait, we can probably help her.
I want to pull out my musket take a knee.
Okay,
you back.
I'm just going to cast whole person on Marley.
I'm gonna stealth and try and move around. Is there any sort of, like, pillars or anything, I assume?
How about I give you guys a map?
Yeah.
That would be wonderful.
That'd be awesome.
Okay.
It's up at the top.
There looks to be pillars. I'm gonna try and stealth over and kind of hide behind one of those and have my bow at the ready.
Okay. I'm dragging Jessica, trying to get her to get her. Hey, you gotta save her.
I'm gonna move to the side.
Which one do I save? I don't know what's going on.
So Jessica, you're casting hold person.
Yeah. Marley's the one talking about killing something, so I'm gonna do whole person.
As soon as the girl with the green hair says this, watch as Marley kind of, like, raises one of her wrists and takes a knife that you didn't see clenched in the other one and brings it and is about to bring it slashing down across her wrist just as the hold person spell takes place and she's just frozen there. Her eyes go wide and she's just looking around in absolute horror at this point. The girl with the green hair, like, kind of looks down at Marley and says,
it's all right. It's all right. You won't have to be in much pain much longer.
It's here that we're going to take our 5-minute break.
What?
All right, I can deal with that. All
right. So!
I got to dip that.
Son of a beast thing.
Jeez.
Hopefully, guys, you guys are enjoying tonight's Riot Sessions. Welcome to this... guys, we need to take a bathroom break, do beer stuff, grab some water, do what you gotta do. Hi, I'm ShadowHack90.
I haven't finished one beer.
I haven't had any, surprisingly, tonight.
I'm on to this.
Good for you. Hi, guys. Welcome to the Riot Sessions. If you're new to the channel, this is I'm the Blue Ranger's channel. He's one of my really good buddies. We do our outreach session here every the first Sunday of every month. Just have a good time. We get a chance to just go explore a fantasy world, play some Dungeons and Dragons. It's a lot of fun. If you are wanting to know who I am the Dungeon Master, ShadowHack 90 or Nathan. I like to be called. You can call me either or. I don't really have a problem with either one. I am a sometimes streamer when I have time and I am not in school doing projects, and I like to hang out. A giant nerd, in case you can't tell yet, even though I failed at my Tolkien history and I feel really ashamed of that.
Sure.
I do. it's depressing. But glad you guys are stopping by and hopefully enjoying the content. All these stuff goes up on YouTube my stuff goes up on Monday. I think Blue's tries gets his up on Monday as well. Aw, thanks, Storms. Aw, that's a thank you. Love you too, buddy. That felt weird. You can find me at twitch.tv/shadowhack90, as well as if you go to YouTube and just type in shadowhack90 or the Nerd Dumb, you can find me there. Most of our previous Dungeons and Dragons sessions, it's a lot of fun. Hey, Rams, who are you? Where can people find you?
Are you asking me?
Sure.
You know me, Nathan.
I don't know you.
For like a year now. I'm Ramsbug. I don't stream. I do this on Sunday nights, and on Wednesday nights you'll find me also here on twitch.tv/imblueranger for the Weekly Apologies podcast, where we talk about games and Twitch and whatever else strikes our fancy. We have some fun guests. I don't think I can tell who our guest is just yet, because I don't think it's confirmed, but we have some exciting guests up ahead, and that's Wednesday nights at 8:30 Eastern, right here. But you'll find me around. I mod for a bunch of people and a bunch of really cool people, and I enjoy building community and being a part of it.
That's true.
Follow me at Twitter. At Ramsbug.
It's true. Ramsbug. You should do all of that. You should do all of that type of stuff. It's amazing.
Yep.
On Twitter.
On the Twitchwats. Intriguing. Mr. Bedrock.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, who are you?
My name's Cody Bedrock.
Is that really
36?
Is that really who you are?
My real name is Cody. It is. In a nutshell. But in order to find out more about me, you guys gotta come on over to my channel at twitch.tv/CodyBedrock36, and you'll find out so much more. You know, I mean, there's so much more to what you just see here Sunday nights at 7:30 playing the Riot Sessions.
You mean there's much more to Brontor? There's a whole town of
absolutely.
There's a whole town of Bedrock that I can visit and vacation in?
Every week.
Oh my god.
As a matter
Cody,
of fact.
That's amazing.
But yeah, guys, starting this week, starting Monday, about 7:30 PM, I will be starting my new run through all of the Kingdom Hearts games. I just got them on PlayStation 4, and it's gonna be a blast. It's gonna be like the first time I played it, because I haven't played it in like 5-6 years. So you guys are in for a treat. So if you come over to CodyBedrock36 at twitch.tv, you guys will gonna have a great time this week, and I hope to see you there.
Awesome. Guys, make sure you go vacation, hang out, book your trip to the Bedrock Resorts and Suites. There's some wonderful stuff over there. Make sure you go check it out. Hey, you of the clan of the Shadows and the Khans. Who are you?
I am a member of Clan Khan.
No, but really, who are you?
I'm Shadow Khan.
Who are you?
Khan! All right, I do a lot of the Twitch stuff, twitch.tv/ShadowCon. Do a lot of variety stuff. We've been doing story games and Cards Against Humanity on Mondays, Spooky Tuesdays, kind of free play Fridays and Thursdays. And if you didn't know already, on Sundays at 7:30 Eastern Time, I do Dungeons & Dragons with a couple of okay people. But you can also find me on Twitter. I have the same tag, or is it the same name? I don't know. You can find me on Twitter. You'll have to look, though. I'm not telling you what might be my Twitter handle, which might possibly be ShadowCon. I have no idea who's gone.
I just want to say that you do spoops on Tuesdays. I don't know. This is Tuesday now. On Tuesdays? Tuesdays, right?
Tuesdays. Yes.
Yes.
Tuesday.
His spoopy streams are fucking incredible. Like, they're
really
so good.
He's got good spoops.
I don't actually watch a lot of Twitch myself. I should really watch more, but I'm so busy. But I usually try to make time to watch his Tuesday spoop streams because they're so good. Just putting it out there.
They're pretty good.
All right.
Great spoops.
If you really want to see a guy crap his pants on Twitch, that Tuesday's where you're at.
He does. It's awesome.
They're really damn funny. And then Cards Against Humanity is always a hoot too.
Yep. Yes. If you're able to let down your inhibitions and just enjoy what's happening.
By all means, if you are a fragile soul,
don't come by.
Please don't come by. It is meant for the people who very much enjoy the dark, crude, lewd humor. And if you do not like that kind of thing, you do not have to be there.
All right. Hey.
I have no idea who's gone.
Hey, Zach. Or Geth.
Hey.
Or not the lane.
Hey, Geth. Zach the lane.
He's a nobody.
Are you Geth the lane?
I am Zach not Geth. The lane, a.k.a. Geth.
Who are you?
My name is Zach, everybody, and I don't stream. I'm not on YouTube. I am on Twitter, and my handle's up here somewhere above my head. I think it'll scroll ever so often. Yeah, you can find me there. Occasionally, I tweet stuff. I can't remember if I tweeted this week or not. I didn't. Shit.
It's always an anger. For me, it's always like an anticipation. I wake up in the morning, I check to see if Zach tweeted, and like if he does, they're normally pure gold. Otherwise, I sit there and I just cry a little bit inside.
I try to make it good. I mean, I've only got 140 characters, so you know it's got to be good what gets in there. So
he's very selective.
Yeah, and that in essence, I'm going for quantity or quality over quantity. That's what I'm going for.
Sounds good.
Hey, very good.
Hey, person whose channel we're actually on. I want you to get really deep.
Oh, okay. So.
I want you to get really deep and introspective here. But who are you?
Hello. I'm the Blue Ranger.
And if you're watching this live right now, you're on my channel. And if you're watching this on YouTube, there's a 50-50 chance you're watching it on my channel. I'm a variety caster and part-time entertainer here on Twitch. I Mondays we play horror games. Wednesdays we have the podcast, which I know. Is my mic doing that thing? No, we're good. I know Rams always brings up the podcast on Wednesdays in her bit, but Weekly Apologies podcast Wednesdays at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And the first Sunday of every month, the Riot Sessions will be here on this channel. But yeah, we just like to have fun. This channel, we're the Break Room. This is the Blues Crew. And we just like to have fun and play a whole bunch of different stuff. Just like Cody likes flexing. Just like Cody likes flexing. There you go. I like it.
I can't flex. Shoot. I'm a stick.
You can have some of mine if you want it.
Shoot. Shoot.
You know what happens when I flex?
You guys know which way the weight room is? Is it that way? Or is it that way?
Wow. Anyone else got anything that they want to add before we jump back into it?
I'm selling a shirt right now, and it's really cool.
It's actually pretty amazing. I really want it in my life.
Teespring.com/Blue Ranger. Check it out.
Ranger.
Did the run already print? I thought I bought one.
Yep. They every 3 days they print.
Have you gotten yours?
No, I actually bought in the second cycle. Yeah.
I'll have to check my email.
Guys, we got a lot of fun stuff coming up towards in the future for Riot Sessions. I'm excited to show you all of it. A lot of us have been working very diligently on making it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to make it look awesome. So I'm hoping in the next few weeks we can get that up here. But it will be up and ready when it is ready. So
just yep.
On how all that is progressing. Are you guys ready to pick in?
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
Okay. So, yep. Jumping back into tonight's episode of the Riot Sessions. You see two girls, one with brown hair, two gnomish girls, who is now currently frozen, one wrist up in the air, the other one holding a knife as though it was about to get struck straight down. Her eyes go wide and freak out. The girl with the green hair stands up next to her and just kind of, you hear her voice echo throughout the chamber. It's all right, Marley. You won't have to worry about it much longer. Jessica, I need for you to roll a D100.
Yeah.
Can I wait? There's no more doing anything. Like I
no, no. This takes place. This takes place as you cast your hold person.
Gotcha. What is that?
It's my PS4 freaking out. It does this every now and then. It's just like I'm gonna just start hitting buttons out of nowhere. It's just and I'm just like, what the heck are you doing?
Sounds like an ER.
Like I it randomly just ejected the disc for Destiny. So
Jessica. Okay. Interesting. Cool. Okay. So, currently, currently you still see this scene before you. Marley's eyes go wider and more crazy. And like you look, it looks as though she's struggling to like to move and just like to do something. And she can't, she's stuck. What else are you guys doing? As the rest of you kind of dart off, like a few, you dart one way, a few, you dart the other way. Tom, if you jump behind a pillar trying to get break line of sight, go ahead and roll a stealth check. Unless you already did, at which point I missed that. Nope, you did. Cool. Gotcha.
Did.
All right, cool. Got it. Move you behind your pillar. Doop. Dryden, where are you headed to?
I'm going to stand right in the open.
Okay. Jessica and Brontor. I don't have a Brontor.
No Brontor.
That's
the Brontor. I do have it. Can I cast another spell? I thought I didn't have it prepped.
Stand by.
There we go. There's Brontor. Okay, cool.
Brontor. Oh, there he is.
Oh, hey,
hello.
Man.
Hello.
Hello. Okay.
Welcome to the party.
I have to actually touch the person, so I'm going to go ahead and go over here.
Where are you headed to?
Hold person's a touch, I believe.
Let's check.
I don't think it is.
I don't think so.
Oh no, 60 feet. Never mind. Back it the fuck up. There we go.
Yeah, I'm gonna dive to the old left side there.
Okay.
Kind of hide over.
That awkward moment here. Someone just measured the distance to Dryden. Right.
The girl with the green hair looks over at all of you, and says, "I recognize you. You're the ones from before. You were able to find us quite sooner than I was expecting." She reaches over to where Marley's hand is currently has the knife in her arm, in her hand, and she reaches up and pries the knife out from Marley's
grip. I want to shoot her arm.
Shoot. Who are you shooting?
Sakona's arm.
Okay, okay, go ahead and roll your attack.
I'm going to use Deadeye to make sure I hit.
Gotcha.
25 to hit?
Yeah, that'll hit.
14 damage.
You just see the arm just go like flying backward. And you just see her arm just get wreathed in smoke from where the bullet hit. You glance down and her arm just kind of is dangling at her side. You know her arm is just completely torn to shreds and just shattered at that point. But yet, nevertheless, you see her raise her arm up, look down at it, and you see the flesh crawl over it. And for an instant, you see it shift from the pale tan skin of the gnome to this very vibrant green scaly color, and then back to that tan skin tone where she just kind of messes with her fingers and flexes them for a second. Glances over at you and says, "You shall not take her from me. She is very dear." I would like you all to roll initiative.
Initiative!
I knew I should have ended this last night.
Damn it, Brontor.
17.
What? Why? How do we get 3 17s, a 16, and an 18?
All right. Let's see here. Initiative rolls. We have got starting at the top. Ooh, this will be interesting.
Wait, did Geth go?
Nope.
Yeah. Did 14.
Yep.
Okay. Oh, he's 14. Right. Way to break the whole thing.
Brontor.
Brontor, 18, baby.
18.
Uh,
Okay. Tomf and Jessica at...
And Dryden.
Tomf, Jessica, and Dryden. Oh, wow.
All 17.
And Dryden. All at 17. Who am I missing?
Geth.
Geth. At the 14. 14. Gotcha. Okay. All right. Geth, how much damage did you do on that first shot?
14.
14, gotcha.
Was that the double shot musket?
It was the double shot, but I didn't crank the bolt.
Oh, okay.
So I've still got one in the chamber.
Okay, I was just curious if it automatically did that or if you had to...
Okay, so... Okay, so top of the round. Brontor, you see as Sukona's... you see as her form just kind of shivers for a second before she just stands there looking at you, her hair kind of blowing in a little bit of wind that kind of just is flowing in from from where you guys came in from. I gotta roll for Harshnag as well. Harshnag. Oh, god damn it, people.
Harshnag's doing well.
Yeah, he is.
GG, Harshnag.
Not as well as I'd like him to, but he's doing all right. Okay, cool.
I blame the government.
Cool. Okay. So you see her form shift just for a slight second, and then her burning emerald eyes just look directly at all of you. What do you do, Brontor? You have initiative.
I cast Crimson Rite.
Okay.
On my hammer with Cleansing Rite.
Okay.
And I just hold still for now.
Okay. You hear this. You hear this. Sound crimson rite, and the blue energy just ignites around your warhammer. You can stay put, looking ready, get ready for your attack. Brings us to Tomf, Dryden, Jessica. Who's going first?
I'm gonna go first and cast bless on Dryden, Tomf, and who else is doing this with us?
Geth or Brontor, the normal
Harshnag's
other
also,
two people
Harshnag's
here.
Also in here as well.
At the same time.
It's me, Dryden, and you are the only ones at the same time, and then Brontor is ahead
gotcha.
Of us.
Gotcha. Let's go ahead and do Tomf.
Tomf, gotcha.
Okay, you got Tomf and Dryden. Who is the third?
Geth.
Yep, okay.
Okay.
I don't know. I thought maybe you said my name twice.
All right, cool.
Oh.
Solid.
Oh, I'm not listening.
All right, so Jessica's... Gotcha. Okay. All right, is that all you're doing?
Hold on. This dispel a concentration. Sorry, let me just look this up. Aberration, instantaneous. It's an action. Yep, that is all I'm doing. All
right, brings us to Tomf and Dryden. What are you guys doing?
Dryden, you can go ahead.
All right, Dryden first.
Well, this is the part where Dryden gets dumb and almost gets himself killed. What do we got for distance here? Oh, man, it's like my entire movement. Well.
Enough.
Well, oh, my God. Okay, I'm even a little nervous here. I'm going to throw... I've got two javelins that I'm going to throw and try to, I don't know, disable her, disarm her a little bit, just kind of slow her down.
Yeah.
It's really all I got. So, tossing them. I meant to rage, and I didn't.
Nope.
Can I still rage? Nope. All right.
I mean,
well, I'm gonna...
you can rage at the end of your turn, but...
Yeah, I'm going to toss both of them and then rage.
Okay.
And I have a 15 to hit.
Okay.
And then
and you're blessed.
To hit.
And you're blessed.
And you're blessed.
Oh, wait.
And you're blessed.
Oh, thanks, guys. I have a
I
9
blessed.
To hit.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. You take both javelins. Boom. Boom. Just send them flying and buzzing quickly towards the small gnomish girl who is currently in front of you. You watch as her form you watch as her, like, you swear both of them are dead on, and you watch as her form just, boom, just dodges out of the way for one, lands on, she kind of, like, lands on one, like, lands crouching down on a three-point land, like, kind of in 3 points, and then leaps high in the air, much higher than you were originally expecting before, like, just as the second one passes directly underneath her. They both embed themselves back in the back wall, boom, behind her. She lands very gracefully on 2 feet. Her, like, dress kind of just flying out around her. Her hair just kind of blowing back. This still very vibrant green color. Her emerald eyes looking at all of you and says, "Pitiful. She is mine and mine alone." Tom. Oh, Dryden. Hold on. You still have movement and a bonus action.
No, he. Oh, yeah, no.
I rage.
You rage. Gotcha. And you're staying put.
Rage.
Rage and staying put. Rage and staying put. Gotcha. Okay.
I get really, really mad.
All right. Tom, you're up.
Am I hidden from her sight?
You are currently not within line of sight of her. You feel pretty stealthy.
Don't tell me my feelings.
Don't tell me who I am. Oh, I gotta check. Wow. Yeah, no, I can't go anywhere. I'm gonna whip around the corner.
Okay.
And, sorry, I had to eat some popcorn.
Yeah.
There we go. Yeah, I'll whip around this corner. I'm still kind of just using the pillar as kind of
cover.
Sub-cover.
Yeah, I gotcha. Okay.
And you know what? I'm gonna sharpshooter her with an entangling arrow.
Yeah.
And a regular arrow. So there's entangling arrow. So, and I do have an advantage.
Mm-hmm.
So this is entangling arrow shot.
Okay. Why do you have advantage?
Because it's the first round. She hasn't done anything yet, correct?
Nope, she has gone already.
She did go?
Yep.
Oh, okay. I didn't know she did her turn.
Well, she already went.
Rip that dream.
Well, that sucks.
She tried to grab the...
Well, anyways, it works because I had lucky perks, so...
Yeah, he did.
He did have lucky.
So that'll be a 19 to hit.
Okay.
Oh! All right, so for my next one, I cast Hunter's Mark.
Okay. So you take the arrow, fire it, phew, you watch as it erupts in just this tangle of brambles as it is flying through the air. You watch as it hits, it impacts, and then whew, passes right through her body, and just clatters down to the ground.
Damn.
And I see this?
Yeah, you see this.
Okay. It's at that point I do Hunter's Mark.
Okay, you feel the hunter's mark go, but it finds no purchase.
Finds no purchase. Cool. Well, I'm gonna bolt straight at Marley.
Okay.
So let's see. Where am I at? So there's one. Two.
You what, mate?
Which one's Marley for our sake? Red or orange?
Marley is this one. The red one.
Okay, yeah, I'm bolting straight towards her.
Okay.
And as I'm going, I yell to Dryden. Dryden, help me! And okay. That's where I'm going.
Okay, cool.
I still have movement! Can I help him?
Since technically you're going at the same time, yeah, sure, why not?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, I'm on that still. So I come just here. Okay. I don't know what his plans are, but I'm bigger than him.
All right. This brings us to Harshnag. He's going to take a step in, kind of glance around, because he watches the entangling arrow. Yeah, he watches the entangling arrow hit, kind of just pass through, and he says, "What sorcery is this? Who are you, sorceress and temptress? What are you
What are your plans? What are you wanting with this youngling? That's all he really does at this point. He has his hand on his axe, and he looks like he kind of like twirls it, and slams it into the ground with this. You shall not pass.
Twirls.
All right. All right. This brings us to Geth. You're up.
All right. So I saw Tom's arrow go through her.
Yes.
All right. Then I'm going to reload the bullet that I expended on my musket.
Yep.
So yep. I've got the two again. And I'm going to pull the bolt. And so it engages the second chamber.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'm going to hold, I'm going to point it directly at Sakona. And I'm going to hold my action to where the trigger is basically whenever I see her transform, okay. I want to blast her.
Okay.
Chew.
All right. This brings us to Marley's turn. She's going to try and make her saving throw. Saving throw is a for Jessica's DC against hold person is a 13, I believe.
13.
She rolls with a natural 16. So you see as her as Marley's form just as she like busts as she kind of like breaks through the magical barrier. This brings us to Dryden. I need to roll a
D100. Yay!
D100, go!
I choose you! Hey!
Hey!
Interesting. Okay.
Uh-oh.
Ocho Cinco.
Ocho Cinco.
Real confusing. Okay. That's funny. Okay. You see Dryden and Tom, as you guys are racing towards Marley, you see her break free of her magical bonds. She looks down at the knife in her hand, looks over at her wrist, and she looks up at you, sees you just racing, and her eyes go wide and goes, and she brings her the knife up to her wrist, and you see her image shift. As she raises the knife up to her wrist, you see almost what it looks like, kind of like a small train of arms kind of follow behind her, almost as though there's multiple of her occupying the same space. Okay. She looks down at herself. She takes a step back, and as she takes a step back, you see two of the same Marley, kind of same form of Marley, end up standing directly in front of you, not aggressive or anything, but just standing in front of you, and both all three having the same expression, the same kind of like don't get any closer, don't. That's about all she gets to in her turn. Brontor, your turn.
Yep. Hold on 1 second. My movement is character sheet. Uh, 25.
What are you doing?
I'm just looking to move.
Okay.
30. It's 30. So 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. I'm gonna move to here.
Okay.
And just keep my action ready. And I should be good there.
All right, what's the trigger?
Anybody who gets within melee range.
Okay. All right. Brontor, as you're racing forward, as you're racing forward and getting ready to go in and do whatever is about to take place. You hear off to your right hand side this, and you hear the voice once again say, "She's mine." I need for Brontor, Dryden, and Tomp to make Constitution saving throws.
Oh, I'm all about that shit.
Yeah, oh, it is.
No!
14.
I have such a good modifier.
critical miss.
Oh, I'm all about
that. Okay. So Brontor, Tomf, and Dryden, as you guys are just continue racing towards Marlee, you don't pay any attention. Brontor, as you're racing forward, you see just out of the corner of your eye, just in time, this almost like kind of green cloud that just kind of seems to hover in midair before, boom! It gets flung straight at you. It completely envelops you and in a 30-foot cone.
Oh shit!
And then a 30-foot cone from this point envelops Dryden, Tomf, and Brontor.
Damn.
Let's see here. Brontor and Tomf. Dryden and Tomf both take 42 points of poison damage.
Shit.
So 21.
And 21 halved for Dryden. Brontor, you also take 21 since you succeeded the saving throw.
Okay.
Well then.
So you're dead.
Brontor, as you
I'm at 40.
Brontor, as you're coughing up and the cloud kind of begins to dissipate just a bit, and you glance over and you see these burning emerald eyes staring at you out of the darkness. Geth and Jessica and Harshnag as well. You also, as you just watch this giant cloud of green gas just envelop your friends, you watch as two wings, green and dark, just rise up out of it. Leathery, almost bony, and you watch as this snake-like head with a snout and maw just almost as deadly as you've ever seen, as you watch as this green dragon just appears emerging out of the green smoke.
Damn, like peace dragon?
Yeah, he's fuzzy.
Except it's more scaly than that.
Oh, yeah. Shit.
Okay, not fuzzy. Scaly. Sorry.
All right. Cool. This brings us to...
Can I use my trigger?
Yep. So, Geth, you get your shot off at it.
All right. Go for it. I'm going to do Deadeye Sharpshooter on this one as well.
All right. That's going to be...
Oh, shit. but I'm really lucky also.
Well, you also are blessed.
And you're also blessed. Yeah, let me do my bless real quick, and then I'll decide. No, I'm kind of lucky. I think I'm lucky on this one also. Is that allowed, Mr. DM?
Yeah, if you want to take the lucky on this one, you can.
All right.
This is what, your second lucky?
My first lucky, second grit.
Okay, gotcha. Cool.
Yeah, because I think we rested.
That's much better.
Yeah, you're feeling lucky. Yeah.
All right, so a 25 to hit, or 23 to hit.
That'll hit.
And the second bullet, D12 plus 4. The second bullet's another 7, so 21, 31 damage with sharpshooter.
Gotcha. Okay. Nice. So, the bullets just go flying directly out of the barrel, just in a weird, this crazy helix, and they boom, just slam into the dragon's hide and bone, or the hide, and you see them just kind of impact, and leaving like small gashes on it. Its head rears over here and looks.
You shall not take her from me. She is precious.
Okay. This brings us to Jessica.
Jessica?
Oh, Geth, unless you're moving. Sorry.
I am going to stay still.
Okay. Jessica, you're up.
Okay, so for my action, I'm going to try dispel magic on the dome's still there, right? I don't see it on the map, but I assume it's still there.
The what? The cone?
The cone, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know why that's not showing up.
What kind of cone? Is
the poisonous cone thing?
Ice cream cone? Oh.
Cone heads? Nah.
That's not what I wanted it to do at all.
It, and it's a 30-foot cone, you said?
Yes.
How far does it go?
I'm trying to draw it in.
Because you can do polygon and...
I guess I'm confused on what the cone is. Is it...
It's like... Oh, yeah, that works.
Oh.
Is this an attack or is this magic? I'm not sure.
It was an attack. You've never encountered a dragon like this before. But it appears to be some form of poisonous gas, from what you can tell.
Okay.
Because you're hearing the coughing coming from your friends as they're just hacking up lungs at this point.
I assume that's the cone you were looking for.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was looking for. This is the cone I'm looking for.
Then I'm gonna do my bonus action first, which is mass healing word, which is 1d4 plus 4 for everyone.
Okay.
Okie dokie.
Let me just make sure it's everyone.
Chew.
Up to 6 people. So yeah.
Oh, ignore that.
Oh no.
So everyone gets 6.
Yeah.
And then for my action, I'm gonna have to do it. I'm gonna have to go ahead and do. Sorry. Cure Wounds on Tomf. So I think I have to touch him. Okay. Unfortunately.
Yeah, Cure Wounds is a touch.
Yeah. So I brave it, and I'm gonna go save my friend Tomf.
Okay.
Selflessly.
As you enter the green fog. It fills your nostrils and your lungs. You also need to make a Constitution save throw.
Okay.
Nope. That's 42 points of poison damage as you enter the cloud.
Yep.
Damn.
Luckily, I can heal myself when I do cure wounds as well. But that means I have 3. 3 hit points.
Wait, so you healed yourself and you
when,
have 3?
When she does cure wounds, she has a thing that allows for her to... It basically, she'll get back whatever she heals you as well.
Okay, and what was the heal?
I haven't done it yet.
Oh, okay.
She's at 3.
Oh, I'm going to go ahead and cast it at a second level then.
Okay.
So that would be... When you cast a spell using spell slots and higher, this healing increases by 1d8 for each slot. So 2d8 plus 8?
Yep.
Yep.
You're getting it.
I'm getting it.
Eighteen.
Do I get the full amount back or do I just get partial? Equal.
Cool.
Oh no, equal to 2 plus the spell's level is all I get.
So that's still 16. No, you get 4.
Yeah, she gets 4. Alright.
So you're at 7?
Yeah.
Cool.
Alright, this brings us to Dryden.
Well... I'm raging.
Yep, you're raging.
Life's pretty good right now.
You are coughing up basically a lung at this point, but you're still managing to rage like crazy.
That's nothing. Alright, well, with that in mind, I feel like I should address these 3 singular one-person girls, but I'm not gonna. I'm gonna turn, and I'm gonna take out
the hell.
And I'm going to make a mad dash straight for Captain Dragon.
Yeah.
And I'm going to give him the hell.
Okay. You up there?
And I'm going to use the
You do understand you have to say it that way every time now.
The hell?
The hell?
It can do the plus D4 fire on top of it.
Yep.
So, haha. So,
haha.
Enter
the hell.
17 to hit.
You're blessed.
Might as well. You never know.
19 to hit.
That'll hit.
And it'll do... Wait, a plus D4, right? Yeah. And it'll do... 17 damage.
17 damage. Nice.
And... Okay. Do you want my second attack, too?
I would love your second attack.
All right. Attack time!
The hell.
Swings again! It'll be 19 to hit.
That'll hit.
Plus, I'm gonna use it again. Another D4 hit, so it'll be 16 damage.
Nice. So you go and slash, boom, boom, just once, twice against the dragon hide. The hell actually doesn't manage to cut through as clean as you'd like on either strike, but you do manage to like kind of bust in a few of the scales, and they kind of just go shattering across, and you manage to get like a good chunk in there. Managed to pull it out, leaving some decent wounds. It looks over at you. Its head like kind of turns and snaps at you, but not happy.
And all I'm going to do after that, though, is I'm going to come stand in front of Brontor.
Okay.
Yeah. Not being melee or anything.
Nope. Tomf.
Currently. I'm going to keep running forward and try and. I'm gonna try and grab one of the Marleys.
Okay. Which one are you grabbing?
We'll go far. So we'll go this one first.
Okay. As you race forward and just kind of bust out of the cloud, still coughing, you see the first Marley in front of you, and you just race forward towards her. I believe you actually feel purchase, and you feel her body. Actually, you do lift her up because she's shorter than you. And you lift her up.
Okay. And I'm gonna run back behind this pillar with her.
Okay.
So, going back here.
Okay. So you race behind there with that with this Marley. And she kind of looks at you, and she looks at you and says, "What are you doing? Let go!"
And then, with the rest of my thing, I'm gonna start taking rope out, and tying her up.
Okay, you start tying her up. She is fighting you vehemently, and she still has a knife in her hand at this point as well. And she's like trying to like fend you off with it. Okay. But you managed to dodge out of the way. I'm not like it's not. She's a commoner. You're a level 6 character. You're fine.
Okay. So yeah, I'll wrap her, and then do I have what sort of action? I assume that was standard.
That's most of your action. You have probably a bonus action at this point.
I'm gonna cast Hunter's Mark on the dragon.
Cool. Gotcha.
And that'll end my turn.
All right. This brings us to Harshnag's turn. Harshnag looks over and says. So it's one of your kind, is it? And he lets out this giant, and just this huge giant bellow, and just goes racing, charging straight at the dragon. Boom, 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 boom. His first attack is going to be. Where is it at? Oh! That's going to be a 24 to hit, so that'll hit. So he takes his great axe and just with his giant bellow just and just like goes slashing right at the side. It leaves this the blade actually glows a little bit with this blue with this like very vibrant ocean blue color as it slashes directly into the side of the dragon. The dragon lets out this giant growl. Oof. Did not like that.
looks over and snaps at him and says, "She will be mine, and you, giant, you will know fear and pain like you've never felt before." Okay, Geth, you're up.
All right, I'm going to shift into view here.
Okay.
And I'm gonna yell out to the dragon eye, say, "She's coming with us." As I pull out the pepper box.
Yep.
And Deadeye sharpshooter the first shot.
Okay.
All right, so 23 to hit again.
That's your last grit.
Do what?
That's your last grit.
Yes, that's my last grit.
Okay. Yeah, that'll hit.
I'm gonna sharpshooter again on my second shot.
Okay.
But I'm feeling kind of lucky.
Okay,
on
that's
it.
Your second luck, okay.
That's much better.
Yep.
So another 23.
Okay.
And then I'm going to action surge.
Okay.
And fire off another pepper box.
Yep.
Damn it. 13 plus a bless. Because why not?
What's your misfire rate on the pepper box?
What's the what?
What's the misfire on the pepper box?
The misfire?
Yeah.
Is 2.
Okay, you're fine. 13 hit for the second one?
Nope.
15 to hit.
Okay.
With bless.
Okay, so.
And then the last pepper box shot. Damn. I'll add the bless to it just
In
case. Another 15.
All right, so the first two. Okay, so the first two hit, the other two. You fire just off this rapid thing of shots. You feel, you watch this two impact steadily, and then the final two shots just go boom, tung, just bouncing off of the scales, tung, tung, and just ricochet kind of off. All right.
So 40 damage.
Yeah, nice. All right, this brings us to Marlee's turn. I need for Tomf to roll a D100, please.
Okay. That's the wrong chat. I swear I'm going to do it one of these times. 95.
Jesus. Them 95s. Okay.
Cheer.
Interesting. Okay. Okay, interesting. All right, cool. Good to know. Okay, so all of you... Dryden, Brontor, Harshnag, and... Okay, and Jessica, and Tom. Okay, all of you...
Everybody.
Everyone except for Geth. You all feel this weird kind of... tingle go down your spine, and this kind of just weird chill just go down your spine as you feel just this weird energy kind of just take hold in your body. That's about all you feel at that point.
Oh.
Ooh, I like this.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
All right, this brings us to the top of the round. This brings us to Brontor's turn.
Cool. All right, I'm going to come around here.
Okay.
Flip around. Stand by. And I'm going to swing on this guy, this dragon. With my great weapons master. So... I get -5 penalty on an attack roll.
But if it
hits,
but if
it lands, I get +10.
Yeah.
So let's do that.
Yeah, go for it.
-5.
Wait, is he flanking though?
Yeah, I'll give you advantage on the attack.
Yeah!
Yay!
So 11 minus 5. 9.
Turn 9 to hit.
Yeah.
Nice.
Ooh! you go... Boom! And you feel the impact against the scales, and you just watch as you hit it. You expect there to be damage, but you kind of glance, look at your hammer, and it's just sitting and resting on the dragon scales, seeming to have no effect.
And just, hey, classic Brontor.
It just looks at you. Its head kind of whiffs around at you. Its large toothy maw, smiling and slime, kind of just.
Okay. All right. Okay, party.
Okay, it does get its poison breath back.
Mm-hmm.
So it is going to.
Now, are we still behind the pillar?
You guys are still. You guys are still technically behind the pillar. Yep.
Cool. Just wanted to check.
It is going to unleash. The. Yes. It is going. Is going to unleash another poison breath in this direction. Actually, no. It's going to flap its wings.
Yeah.
It's just going to flap its wings, and it's going to. It is going to do a wing attack against everyone within a 5-foot radius of it. That's going to be a 17 to hit. So 17 to hit against Dryden, Brontor, and Harshnag.
Yeah, it's gonna hit.
All right.
Can I raise my armor class with my bless?
No, unfortunately.
Damn! The way you pulled that away, I thought he was going to be like, yes, actually. No. He's going to be like,
no, unfortunately.
Yeah, yeah, that hits.
Yeah. Okay, so you each you both take 15 points of 15 points of bludgeoning damage as the wings just whip up this whirlwind. Boom, boom. And you both get thrown backward and knocked prone onto the ground. Brontor, you getting actually flung off the back of the staircase. Dryden, you getting pushed back about 5 feet, and you both are knocked prone at this point.
Boo.
Harshnag also takes the 15 points of damage. But just gets battered by the wind, but looks fine. The dragon is actually going to flap its wings and reposition and fly overhead and reposition over here on these stairs. And over here. Okay. That will end her turn. This brings us to Jessica.
Yeah, so I am nearing death. So yeah. I'm going to, if I move, am I going to get like a retaliation?
You are not within melee of it, no.
I'm going to use my movement to GTFO a little bit.
Yeah.
Let's go out of his range over here somewhere. And I'm going to call out to Bahamut with my divinity.
Okay.
Which is 5 times my spell, my level. Yeah. So I get 30. 5 times 6 is 30. Yeah. 30 hit points, but I can't do more than half of my own, so...
Oh, so you're doing Channel Divinity, you get hit points back.
Channel Divinity, gotcha. Yes. Cool. And so the other... I'm gonna get myself back to half, which I can't math right now. I'm gonna get a calculator. Sorry.
That's why they're invented, man.
Cheater.
I know, right?
Your math teacher would be so mad. You're not going to have a calculator everywhere you go.
God, I hate math so much.
Hashtag 2017.
Math.
So I'm going to give myself 22, and the other 8 will go to Brontor.
Gotcha.
Yeah!
Okay, cool. spell again.
Sorry, let me just get this. I just feel better once I enter this in.
That health, that ever-present health bar.
There we go.
I got 8.
You got 8.
Yeah, cool.
8 more.
Thank you.
Cool.
So
way to play favorites.
Yeah.
Health, it has a scratch on them.
You can give me points anytime you want to. Health points.
You're just using
her for your points.
You're just using her for your point. You're just using her for her points. You're just using her for
we're good friends. And she's a cleric. And she does me right every time.
Give me the Fred points.
I've brought you back from the brink many times.
Don't listen to them, Jessica.
My bonus action, on a first level, I'm going to do a healing word for my friend Dryden, which is just 1d4 plus 4. I believe. Yeah, I think that's what it is. Nice. 7. Which means that I also get healing back.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah.
Does that mean I get 7 points?
7 yes. health. HP.
Ooh, girl!
Ooh, buddy. Ooh, buddy.
And then I get 3 myself.
Yep.
Get it. Get it. Get it. Get it. Get it. Get it.
Oh man. Okay. So Jessica, you grasp your holy symbol on your staff and you just feel the warm energy of Bahamut and you feel almost like dragon fire in your belly as your eyes burst open with the platinum energy of Bahamut and you just look over towards Brontor and Dryden and extend your holy symbol in their direction and phew, just two beams of light shoot out from your shootout and boom, just impact Dryden and Brontor. Brontor, you both look down. You find yourself encased in a platinum aura before it just fades back into nothing, and you feel your vitality return to you. Brings us. Is that all you're doing, Jessica?
Yeah, ooh, that's it.
Dryden, you're up.
As you get healed, real good. It fills real you good. With determination.
Push it real good.
All right, so I'm prone, which means that I probably don't have all the movement that I normally have, huh? It
takes half your movement to get up.
Half my movement to stand up in the world of Dungeons & Dragons. Yeah, get you again. Okay, well then what I'm going to do, because I'm a big boy, is I'm going to turn, and I'm going to run straight back at the dragon, but I only get to about here because standing up is so tiring. And I'm just going to hold my movement until I get close enough to that there damn dragon, because that thing's going to burn everything up. And I got a good bowl of barbecue back here. I don't want there nothing to ruin again.
They going to go in the gut in the duck barrel.
What just happened?
I'm holding my movement until I can actually hit the damn
thing. I feel like I'm seeing like Dryden's backstory that I didn't know he had.
Hey, we got a good candle over here. I'm going to go round him up right now.
Dryden from that South Louisiana swamp, I tell you what.
Oh,
I tell you, now go bring it up. They're going to cry that going down real
quick. You want to get them gator? Shoot him, Elizabeth.
I don't know where Tomf is at, so I'm going to hold off on his, and we'll move to Harshnag. Harshnag is going to...
Come on, Harshnag.
Going to rush over this way. He's going to get here. Awkwardly squeezing between the pillars, and he's going to unleash his attack. That's going to be a 21 to hit. Nice. Yeah, that'll hit.
Yeah, Harshnag.
Damn. He takes his axe and just goes and slams it down. The dragon at this point reels back in the air, kind of going to like trying to catch the the axe, and it does it catches the axe, but Harshnag continues to dig deep and actually pushes the axe a little bit into the claws of the dragon. The dragon lets out as it reaches back and bites down onto Harshnag as its snake-like head reaches forward and bites down onto Harshnag's neck. It pushes the axe off before landing back down on fours and curling back into its ready stance, getting ready for the next round of attack. Tom, you're up.
Damn.
All right. Well, I'm still gonna kind of Is Marley tied up now?
She is tied up at this point, yeah. Or this one is. The other two actually darted this way a little bit as they saw you kind of as they saw you grab the one Marley.
Okay. Well, I'm just gonna keep this one
okay.
Kind of near the pillar, trying to keep her out of direct view of the dragon.
Yeah, she's still squirming and reeling and going like, "Let me go! Let me! Sukuna would never do this! She would never! She wants to help me!" That's basically what she's saying. She's kind of in hysterics at this point.
Cool. Well, I'm going to use Hail of Thorns.
Yeah!
At a second level.
Hail of Thorns.
And big money, no whammies. I get to roll again. I get to roll again.
Feeling lucky.
I'm just laughing at big money, no whammies.
And I'm blessed. Hold on.
Bless.
17 to hit.
Reach back. Fire. You see the arrow fly forward. It bursts into thousands of needles. Before it can even explode and just send the shower of needles, the dragon's wing just boom and sends it scattering against the wall off to the side.
Well, I'm just gonna make a second attack.
Go for it.
Just a regular attack. Yep, 12.
this one actually fires and actually hits the dragon square in its back, but the arrow just seems to shatter as it impacts the scales. The scales are a little bit more hardy than you were expecting it to be. This brings us to Geth.
All right, I'm gonna chase him a little bit and shift back to the center to catch line of sight.
Yep.
And I'm gonna use my last two pepper box.
Yeah, go for it.
A 26 and a 27 to hit.
Both will hit.
For 21 damage.
Damn. Nice. What type of damage is that?
Piercing.
Gotcha.
Kinetic.
Gotcha, cool.
They're psychic bullets. No, it's piercing.
Pew pew!
Okay, interesting. Okay, cool. Alright, this brings us to... Alright, anything else, Geth?
Actually, yes. I'm going to use my bonus action for my offhand.
Okay.
18 to hit.
That'll just hit.
Nice. All right, and it is only 2 damage because it's without my modifier.
Gotcha. All right, brings us to Marley's turn. I need for Geth to roll a D100, please.
D100. Fourteen.
Okay. Tomf.
Lay it on me.
I need for you to make a wisdom saving throw.
Of course.
Are you smart enough to get past the dragon?
Find out next time on Dragon Ball Z.
8.
No.
It's going great, guys. Don't mind me.
Okay. All right. Good to know. I need for you to roll a d10. Oh, nope. Never mind. Hold that. I lied. Don't do that yet. Good to know.
So it was great knowing you all.
Okay, cool. Good to know. All right. Sweet. Oh, boy. Oh, my God. Okay. Okay, it brings us top of the round. Brontor, you are currently prone on the ground.
Get up.
All right, half your movement.
Yep. So I'm going to go 15 feet to here.
Yep.
And I'm done.
Cool.
You do it.
Okay.
I can't control my guy right now for some reason.
That's awkward. I got you, boo.
But
you're also on the ruler.
Yeah, you're not on the pointer.
You weren't on the pointer. You were on the ruler thing, but I got you.
Oh, that'll do it.
Yeah. All right. All right, this brings us to Sakona's turn. All right, Sakona's not liking her happenstance right now. She is going to kind of relocate again and land right here. Harshnag does get a free swing at her. It's a natural one. God damn it, Harshnag.
Yeah, Harshnag.
As he goes to swing a third time at the dragon just manages to duck underneath as boom, the hammer or the axe just goes slamming and embedding itself directly into the stonework. It just with this cloud of dust and debris just going flying everywhere, the dragon whoom, whoom, and flies.
Son of a bitch!
he's like one of us, guys. He's like one of us.
And ends up flying directly over and landing directly between Brontor and Dryden. It's going to make two attacks. Oh, no, it's going to make three attacks. One with its bites and two with its claws. The bite is going to be against Dryden.
Of course.
That is going to be a 21 to hit.
No.
Yeah. you take a total of 15 points of piercing damage. This is not halved because due to the wild magic, everyone who is in a 30-foot sphere.
Well, wait a minute. If he's making a bite attack on me, I'm holding my attacks. Is he close enough for me to retaliate?
Yeah. So as she attacks you.
Cheer.
As she attacks and this happens, you get your chance to attack as well.
Boy.
Yeah. Let's go.
You still take a grand total of 15 points of piercing damage due to the wild magic. Everyone is vulnerable to piercing damage, so instead of taking the double, you just take the normal amount. So you take 15 points of piercing damage, and then you take 7 points halved of poison damage.
Oh, fine.
I'm just...
Sooner or later, he'll get me below half health.
One of these days. Now's your retaliation strike.
Sweet! All right. So Dryden is sitting there. He's thinking to himself, he's got the hell in hand. He's pretty mad about everything going on. So he swings!
Oh, 15 hit.
Yeah. 17 to hit.
Plus 2. 17
to
hit.
You strike, and there's just sparks that just go flying off as the first attack just skids across the skids across the scales, as the teeth have like sunken into your upper shoulder, and you feel the pain, but you just attack once with it, seeming to no effect. You still have your second attack.
Yeah, I do. It's a 16 to hit.
You're blessed as well.
Oh, can I bless?
Yeah, bless it. Working?
Oh, the bless work? Oh, okay. So it'll be 19 to hit. So that'll do 18 damage.
All right. How do you want to do this?
Yeah!
Yes! he's got me in his throat, and I see his neck right there. I take the axe and I give it everything I got. I'm taking this motherfucker's head off. I'm taking this thing as a goddamn trophy. I swing from the bottom up and I come right underneath and I cut this thing's head right off. Right. I'll take the Reclortus teeth in my fucking neck. I don't care.
That dragon, bro.
With just one arm, you just since the other arm is kind of immobilized with it currently being in the dragon's mouth at this point, you take the arm that currently has the hell in it. You swing once, it just skids across the scales, it being down at the ground now. You take it and with all your might and through the rage, you and you just bring it straight up, slicing and hitting the bottom of the throat. It hits and you for a second think it's not going to go anywhere, and then you remember. And then you say the activation word, and the entire blade head just ignites in flames, and you slice through the entire neck of the dragon, just like butter, as your axe comes flying up above your head with just wreathed in flames. The head and the teeth go, the jaw goes lax on your shoulder. The eyes glance at you in fear. And glance at you in fear, and then they roll back into the head, roll back into the head as the rest of the body kind of and just kind of like wriggles for a bit and collapses down to the ground and just drops to the ground with a giant. The rest of the head still kind of stuck in your body. You manage to dislodge yourself from the teeth. Alive. Still coughing a little bit, but alive. And your foe vanquished.
Cheer.
How's about that shit right there?
Attaboy.
You glance around the room as the dragon's body falls, the head also falling to the ground as Dryden kind of pushes, shrugs it off. You glance over and you see two different Marlies still standing there, looking very wide-eyed, clutching daggers to their wrist at this point. The other Marlie currently like still screaming and or kind of like not like kind of still wriggling, kind of just saying, "Let me go," and just like get these off of me. Right next to Tomf. Sakona.
Okay, so
where are you? Sakona. That's all you really hear her say at this point.
Is there still three of them?
There's still three of them.
Yeah. Fuck. I can hold person one more time.
I said, listen, Marlies, we're on your side.
You do anything, and I end it right here. They both say,
we're not going to do anything to you.
The remaining two say in unison as they hear Jessica say that she can hold person one more time.
We're not going to do anything to you. Hold still.
That's what they all say.
We owe you no harm. We want nothing to do. We want nothing to do with your harm here.
I turn from the distance. I go, do you remember me? I helped you in the battle.
Her head nods. Yeah.
If we wanted to hurt you, I would have done it already. We want to help.
We would have done it by now. We're good. We're your friends.
I can't go on living like this. I never know when the next thing's going to happen.
It's over now.
Hold still. There's no harm to come to you.
You don't understand. I'm the one that's harming people. I'm the one that's harming others around my village and my town.
We can control you.
I can heal you.
That's what she said.
I can help.
She said that. She said you would try to control me.
I want to walk to the middle and I'll put my firearms on the ground and say, Marlie, what happened in the ice chasm? What happened while you were down there?
Orbs of light. Voices. So pretty. Singing beautiful melodies to me.
You have nothing else to worry about.
You keep
saying
that.
We can control your pain. We can control what you were feeling.
I can't control you. I can heal you, though.
Marlie.
Do you want this to go away? I can heal you.
Marlie, I know of anguish. We're your friends. You can believe us. We know powerful wizards that can cure whatever you have.
Make a persuasion roll.
You've been under a lot of stress.
Geth, make a persuasion roll.
Yes!
Fun.
Let's go!
Yes!
On that 14,
It just tipped.
She looks at you and says, who can control me? Who can control this power? Who can help rid me of it?
There's people out there.
Who?
That can help you.
Shadow, are both of them doing this?
Yeah, both of them at the same time are basically saying this. It's like a weird echo at this point, but they're both like directly talking to Geth at this point. Who?
There's powerful wizards.
Who?
Artemis is one.
We know of someone in Neverwinter that is extremely powerful, and they know much of the magical arts.
Let them know they've been in a vulnerable place, and we can help them.
I'm gonna go ahead and scoot forward and cast Calm Emotions. I can't scoot myself. I'm like right here. I cast Calm Emotions.
All right. So as you start inching forward and you begin like the verbal and the hand motions in order to cast the Calm Emotions, you see as she digs the knife that's currently held at her wrist a little farther in, and you see this blood trickle begin to dribble down her wrist at this point. I told you to stay. I told you don't.
I look at Jessica and I say, Jessica, I got this.
I don't even need to scoot.
You're gonna be okay.
I say, Marley, some things have happened. I'm not gonna tell you I know what it is, but there are people who do, and there's people that can help. There's people that can reverse this. There's people that can make it better. There's people that can teach you.
I don't want to be taught. I just want it gone.
Then we will help you. We will take you wherever we need to. And you will return back to your family, and everything will be normal again.
Who is this in Neverwinter that you speak of?
Artris. His name's Artris Kynber. He's a powerful wizard. And there are many like him.
Many like him.
That know much of the arcane arts.
Know much.
Make another persuasion roll. With advantage, because of this whole setup.
While this is happening, I just turn to our giant friend, who's Harsh, and I just signal to him to sit, and I sit as well. We're big, imposing people, and it's always been my thing that sit and just become non-threatening.
Yep.
All
right. I ask Harshnag.
There's this loud as Harshnag sits down, as he kind of nods at you and just there's this loud as he sits down, places his axe across his lap, and pretty much like sits in the exact same pose that you're sitting in.
I asked Harshnag for a swig of his
He doesn't even acknowledge you.
Flask.
He doesn't even acknowledge you at this point. He's too focused on what's happening in front of him.
I'm still prepping Calm Emotions. If she moves the knife anymore, I'm gonna cast it.
She looks at all of you, looks primarily at Geth and says, "Artris, he can cure me of this."
Yes.
You're sure?
I am.
What's he like?
He's a hero of the lands. I've heard many stories of him, of saving innocent people and helping many villages in his travels.
You won't be safe if you travel with me.
That's fine. We can handle our own. We'll be ready. You'll be safe with us.
It's at this point I'm going to start untying the other Marley.
Okay. You start untying the other Marley, and she, as you untie her, she looks up at you and says, "It's about damn time."
I was worried about you.
And there's a, as her form just like evaporates into smoke, the rope drops down to the floor. One of the other Marleys drops, also kind of evaporates into smoke. And there's just one Marley standing there, and she looks at you and says, "Where's Sukuna? Where's my friend?"
Your friend was lying to you. She was a demon. She was trying to trick you and control your power.
Why?
I don't know. I can only assume it was for evil. Just please, put down the knife, and we'll find help.
She looks down at the knife, the blood slowly dripping down past the wound. Drip, drip, onto the ground.
Let me know what goes wrong.
She pulls her knife away, drops her wrist. To Neverwinter. And to Artris Kynber we go.
To Neverwinter.
And it's here that we'll pick up next session in the Riot Sessions.
Woo!
There we go.
Some I'm waiting to find out that Geth has like a lost daughter somewhere or something.
Ladies and gentlemen who are watching on YouTube and on Twitch, thank you for hanging out tonight. If you are new to any of these channels and new to the Dungeons and Dragons scene or the ride sessions, I have been your DM, ShadowHack90. We'd like to hang out here, play some Dungeons and Dragons every now and then. If you're watching on I'm the Blue Rangers channel, make sure that you hit that follow, like, subscribe button on either his YouTube or Twitch page. Show him some love, touch his butt. He's a beautiful man. As well as make sure you go and touch all of these other people, wonderful, amazing individuals' butts, and show them some love, because they are all wonderful people. Love them all. Guys, we'll be back next week, Sunday, 7:30 Eastern. We'll be actually be over on my channel, twitch.tv/ShadowHack90, 7:30 Eastern time for more of the ride sessions. And if you want to catch up on past episodes, you can always find them on YouTube at either youtube.com/ I'm the Blue Ranger, or you can find them at ShadowHack90's YouTube page as well. Hope you guys enjoyed tonight. Catch you guys later. Have a good one, guys. Bye.